John's Pizza at a time when their brand was in trouble. And it involves something he called the $20 homeboy rule.
Homeboys don't like to break $20. Let me explain. So they were charging $22 for a small pizza. I said, no, the homeboys, if I can get a small pizza for $10, get some chips and get a soda and not have to break that $20, we could change things around. So they did that. They lowered prices, and now we're back on top.
Jack was a big part of turning around Papa John's with thinking just like that. His next move? Owning an NBA team. I'm Bloomberg's Justin Milliner on the Black Business Beat.
Doors take us to summers away or winter adventures and afternoon getaways. Your dedicated Fidelity advisor can help you open those doors by working with you on a comprehensive plan to help you reach your wealth's full potential. Because doors were meant to be opened. Visit fidelity.com/wealth. Investment minimum supply. Fidelity Brokerage Services, LLC, member NYSE, SIPC.
Hi, I'm Kamiko, the founder of Miko's Hot Chicken. When we started our family restaurant, we were also raising a family. But let me tell you, it wasn't easy. Our Chase Inc. card was there to reward us on all of our business needs. Now we have a thriving location, and we're hungry for more.
With the Chase Inc. Business Unlimited card, you can earn unlimited 1.5% cash back on every purchase, so your business can go from here to possible. Chase for business. Make more with yours. Real business owners compensated for their participation. Cards issued by JPMorgan Chase Bank, and a member FDIC, subject to credit approval. Terms apply.
The views and opinions expressed on this program do not necessarily reflect that of the staff and management of Good Karma Brands, but are the sole responsibility of the host and guests of this particular show.
America may have many, many days, but they will be full of trouble. There will be no rest. There will be no tranquility in this country. Until a nation comes to terms with our problems.
Bringing you social and political commentary from his mouth to your ears. Breaking down the issues which matter to you.
You are not put here to be a white man's footstool. You are put here to represent the very best in God's word.
Legendary civil rights icon, the Reverend Jesse Jackson in the studio. Reverend Jackson, how are you?
Mr. Reverend, good morning on this chilly Milwaukee morning.
And I am pleased to have one of the founding members of the Black Panther Party, Chairman Bobby Seale. Mr. Chairman, how are you this morning?
Good morning. I'm doing just fine. Thank you.
From Mr. Eric Holder. Mr. Holder, so good to see you. How are you?
Well, I'm fine, man. How you been? It's been a long time. I haven't seen you for a while.
The Dr. Cornel West. Dr. West, how are you, sir?
My dear brother, you're so kind, you're so generous, so man, but I salute you and the work that you were doing there. Doing a magnificent job there in Wisconsin.
Stream live on 1017thetruth.com. Call in with your questions or comments. 833-212-1017. Join us on social media at 1017thetruth. It may not be what you expect to hear, but I will definitely give you what you need to know. Are you ready for the truth?
Truth! You can't handle the truth!
Now, live from the American Family Insurance Studio at The Avenue in the heart of downtown Milwaukee, here is Sherwin Hughes.
Good morning. Welcome to the program. Today's Thursday, April 4th, 2024. Still trying to decipher and make sense out of this influx of data and information that we have about the most recent election on Tuesday. And how do we take that information and use it to better inform ourselves about policy, politics, and the impact of the vote? Because we need to learn as much as we possibly can, because we have two more major elections happening this year. One, I would say, could have potentially seismic implications. So learning everything that we can learn from who voted, why they voted, which direction they voted, and what does that mean for future elections. And I'm not even sure. I used to know how to like talk to voters in a very clear and concise way, and you could make it about the issue. You could make it about the money. You could make it about the policy itself. You can make it about what are the implications right now and what does this policy or this politician or this campaign or this candidate, what does it mean for the future? Very, very simple. You didn't have to get very complicated. But now it seems like there's all these other factors. And what I'm most concerned about is how mistruths and stereotypes and falsehoods are almost as powerful, if not more powerful, than just the plain objective facts. When the information, the additional information was released about the referendum, I'm baffled. I really am. And I need y'all to help me. I need you to help me figure this out. The details of the people that voted yes versus no, they could not be more different. And it's counterintuitive. See, I don't like when stuff is counterintuitive because that means there's a whole bunch of information that I am missing and I can't make it make sense. Because we want things to be easy. We want to read something like, oh, okay, that makes sense. That's easy. Oh, perfect. Okay. I understand that. Let's move on to the next thing. But then every now and again, there are bits and pieces of information that make literally no sense whatsoever. Does it make any sense to you that the majority of the people that voted yes to the MPS funding are white and don't have kids? Does that make any sense to you that 65% of the people that voted for the $252 million referendum are Caucasian and are childless? Now, there's a couple of ways I can go with this. It could be this white liberal. Oh, and they live on the west side. So think Washington Heights, Washington Highlands, the western part of the 10th Aldermanic District that borders on Wauwatosa. Very nice, very expensive homes, very high property taxes already, but a really nice Milwaukee neighborhood, a top-tier north side neighborhood, to say the least, okay? And then the other portion of major yes votes from the referendum were east side folk. Again, a very high property taxes, high income, high levels of education, a lot of 3rd Aldermanic District residents, if you didn't know. The 3rd Aldermanic District has the highest levels of education and income of any Aldermanic District in the city, and it's not even close. So these are the individuals that voted 65%+ yes on the referendum. The majority of them, 80% of these people that voted yes don't have kids at all. No children. Or maybe their children have aged out, but they don't have any kids. I'm trying to figure something out because there's two ways I can go with this. And again, I wish that this was simple. I wish it was just cut and dry. I wish it was parents that had school-age children. They're the ones that voted yes because, yes, they want all of the fundings and all of the art and all of the things in the music classes in the gym or whatever they said was going to be included with the $252 million, which is probably all lies. That would make a lot of sense if parents of school-age children were the ones that wanted the additional funding for MPS. And because here's the thing, if you vote for an increase in your property taxes to fund education, it's a roundabout way of paying tuition. The number of people that I know, very, very good friends of mine, family even, that have moved to suburbs or other counties or other cities, and they pay higher property taxes, but the schools are impeccable. So they basically had to balance out or weigh out, is it more cost effective to buy a house in a different city, a different town, a different suburb, a different neighborhood, pay higher property taxes, or stay in the city of Milwaukee, send my kids to private schools and pay tuition? A lot of times it's more cost effective to buy a house somewhere else because the property value is going to go up. You're going to get more equity, and there's other amenities that go along with moving out of the city and moving to a place that has really high performing schools. So the property taxes that people pay, if you have children, especially multiple children in a district, it's kind of like paying tuition. But there's other amenities that you get when you move out of the city of Milwaukee. Now it depends on where you go. And so that makes sense. But if you don't have children in the school system or you don't have kids at all, why are you in favor of essentially paying tuition, higher property taxes for kids that you don't have? Now, it's either this white liberal sentiment, and oh, of course, the majority of the yes voters on the referendum were Caucasian people. I'm still trying to figure out the whites. The whites are changing on us. I don't know who they are anymore. They used to be very obvious with who they are. They're very chameleon-y. I don't know who they are. I used to know them very well. Now they're just, the understanding of the whites is escaping me, What happened to all the George Floyd whites? Where are they at? What are they doing now? Remember the ones that were out there in COVID? They were protesting and beating up the police back when we thought that the whites loved us. Where are they at? What are they doing? They're voting yes on a referendum is what they're doing. So either, and I know you guys are probably sick of me harping on the referendum, but as more information comes out, more things are being revealed. Because I don't know the people that I share this city with. I thought I did. I don't know y'all. Not like I thought I knew you. And when I don't know you, when I thought I knew you, my anxiety goes up because I don't know what I'm dealing with here. So it's either this bleeding heart, liberal sentiment. Oh, my God, these poor black children. Look at them suffering. Look how dumb they are. Look how poor they are. Look how much jail time they do. Oh, no, we have to do whatever we can. I feel so bad for the darkies that it's okay. I have the money. I don't have children. I have privilege. I will vote for this to help the black kids. You wouldn't know that this public school system where the majority of black children attend is not helping them. These children are being suspended and expelled at a super fast clip. It is not helping them, but they wouldn't know that because they don't have kids in the district. So it's either this sentiment of sympathy, like, oh my God, they need us. Yes, they need the money. Or think about it this way. And this is a much more sinister perspective, but again, you got to keep in mind the history of the people that we are dealing with. Whiteness has never been friendly nor accommodating. It is about money. It is about power. It is about business. It is not emotional. So it's either this bleeding heart liberal sentiment, we have to vote yes to help the black kids because the black kids are subhuman, so we got to help them. Raise my property taxes if you must. I want to help the black kids because I feel so horrible and so guilty about how racist and how prejudiced I've been my entire life. The least I can do is vote yes. And that's probably how a lot of people decided to vote yes on the referendum. But then there's other people. And there's a very fundamental question. How much money would you pay? How much money would you be willing to part with to make sure there was no competition from your enemy? How much would you pay additionally to make sure that you and yours could be safe from your enemy? You know, people pay a lot of money for security. Competition from ethnic, racial minorities creates insecurity. So how much would you pay to be secure? $219 per $100,000 of assessed value of your home seems like a small price to pay. Competition in this nation breeds insecurity. Why do you think they're having a fit about the border? I saw a couple little audio clips from the Donald Trump rally in Green Bay. Camouflage wearing white folks in Green Bay are concerned about the border. Do you know how far the border is from Green Bay, Wisconsin? But the thought of these people coming here and infiltrating our neighborhoods, our towns, our communities, their kids going to our school, they're going to come and take up all of the welfare and all of the stamps for food. It breeds insecurity. If you know that the Milwaukee public school system is a prison to pipeline connection, you would spend more money to maintain the status quo, which is failing black kids. So I'm telling you that even in the Caucasian West Side liberal and the East Side well-educated liberal is the same kind of insecurity that lives in the Trump supporter. They know that if they maintain what MPS is doing, meaning better fund the failure for black children, they will be more protected. Think of MPS as Mexico. I know it's a weird analogy, but we want to keep those kids in it. We don't want them to go somewhere else. We certainly don't want them to go to a private school because the last bastion of school segregation are private schools. Why do you think so many teachers and administrators sending their kids to private schools. Like, I get so mad at my friends that are public school teachers. Y'all see how I treat them when they call me? I hang up on them. Well, Sherwin, I love the public schools, and you need to support the public schools. And they go on and on and on. It's almost like they have bullet points that are scripted. And then I ask them, don't I? What do I ask them, y'all? Y'all know what I ask them. Well, where did you go to school? Well, I went to Rufus King High School, a proud general, or whatever high-performing public high school they went to. And then I ask them, where did you go to middle school? Where'd you go to elementary? St. Jones, St. Catholic's Parish Academy. Or they may have gone to a public school like kindergarten through fifth grade and went to private schools for the rest. There's always been an anti-voucher sentiment. I had to cuss out a liberal on Monday because he, in all of his 27 years of liberal progressive age, was telling me what was best for black children. The blacks, if they just stay in the public schools, will be fine because it's about the money. Do you know that of the – I have the information here somewhere. I got so much information. I got too much information, actually. Milwaukee has – we're in like the top 15 out of 100 cities. Quentin called yesterday and talked about this. We're in the top 15 of highest per pupil funding out of 100 cities, but our outcomes are worse. We're third from the bottom out of like 500-plus cities, 530-some cities when it comes to graduation. This is to trap black children. And so the $252 million is an endowment to trap black kids into a pipeline that's going to get them to an early grave or to a long jail sentence. And I bet when you go to jail, you live a long time, don't you? Because you get good health care. You get to eat food that's probably nutritious. And so I have some information I'd like to share with you. And I want someone to help me understand this because I want to oversimplify everything so it's easy. But I'm running into this roadblock of complication of how 65% of the people that voted to fund NPS don't have kids. And they're Caucasian and live in like two distinct parts of the city that have higher levels of income and education. Yet they want to fund something. And we know that the school system is failing. But why does the narrative of we need more money, we need more money, we need more money? If we get more money, the kids are going to do better. We need more money. We're going to lay off the teachers. You're not laying off teachers in a teacher shortage. What, you going to lay off a teacher just to hire them back? No, they're not laying off any teachers. They lied to us. I don't want to think that black children are under attack. I don't want to think that. But I'm starting to. So let's decipher the data, shall we? You are listening to The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 FM. Make sure you download the free 101.7 The Truth app from wherever you download your dating apps or wherever. And you can stream this program and all the other programs across our lineup all day long. And then go to YouTube and open up the YouTube app and search 101.7 The Truth and then hit subscribe. And then you can look at my face. I'll be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 101.7 The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Truth Nation, Gruber Law Offices, and The Truth have raised the stakes for this year. The One Call, That's All Gruber Cash giveaway is now a 5K giveaway. Yes, you heard it right. $5,000 giveaway. Every weekday on 101.7 The Truth, you will have the chance to be entered to win the 5K giveaway. Listen to The Truth for the One Call, That's All cue to call for your chance to win $5,000. Gruber Law Offices, One Call, That's All. Visit 1017thetruth.com. For official contest rules.
Associated Bank knows your small business isn't just a venture. It's your dream and a vital part of the community. And we're not just a bank. We're your neighbors. We're looking out for you. That's why Associated Bank offers quick online applications and approvals with funding in as fast as one business day, checking with no minimum balances or maintenance fees, and prompt customer service. Explore our products at associatedbank.com/business or visit a branch for more details. Subject to credit approval. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
This is Community Heartbeat, presented by Outreach Community Health Centers on 101.7 The Truth.
There are individuals in our community who certainly need health services, a variety of health services. What if they do not have health insurance? How can you serve that population?
Our community health center allows patients to come to our clinic regardless of their ability to pay, and that's part of our federal funding. You can come to our clinic and be seen based on what we call a poverty level. So anyone 200% or below a poverty level can be seen in our clinic for anywhere from $20 to $40 for that visit. So in other words, if your visit is a $400 visit and you fall on our sliding scale where you pay $20 for your visit, you would not be responsible for the $400. You'd only be responsible for $20 for that visit. Also, our pharmacy prescriptions are very, very affordable as well. Where you would normally pay, let's say for an inhaler, $240 a month for an inhaler, at our facility that would cost you about $4 or $5.
It's very good to know you guys have a sliding scale that makes it very, very affordable.
Garage doors giving you a headache? The best way I know to deal with it is to call my friends at Geis. Family owned since 1955, Geis is the trusted authority on garage doors and openers in southeastern Wisconsin. Trust me, I use them too. Geis has doors and openers for every budget and can even build custom designs to meet your exact preferences. For fast, reliable garage repair solutions, go to geisdoors.com or call 262-784-4250.
Don't think twice. Call Geis.
Elevate your game day gear, or any outfit, with official merchandise from the Milwaukee Bucks Pro Shop. From authentic jerseys to exclusive apparel and accessories, the Bucks Pro Shop has everything you need to showcase your fandom wherever you go. Cheer the deer to victory with authentic Milwaukee Bucks items. Visit us at the Bucks Pro Shop at Fiserv Forum or Bayshore Mall, or shop online at shop.bucks.com.
It's The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
The referendum received about 41,600 yes votes to 39,900 no votes. But the no votes actually won more wards, 172 wards versus 164. Support for the referendum was strongest in neighborhoods along the lake and the near west side. Opposition was strongest on the far south and southwest sides, most north, and Northwest Side wards also voted no. There's a squeeze that is happening, and you probably feel it because I know a lot of you are blaming Joe Biden for it, and it's making you nostalgic for Donald Trump. Like, oh, gas is expensive, and the groceries cost too much, and the inflation or whatever. True, everything is getting more expensive. I mean, look how much stuff cost just in, like, 1980. Everything gets more expensive, right? But also keeping in mind when the federal government, state governments, local governments required a lot of businesses to stop operating during the pandemic. And I, now that I look back on it, we may have overreacted a little bit. But we were cautious because at the time the virus was quote unquote novel. So we had to take all of these precautions. But when you tell a business, a company, a corporation, yeah, you can't distribute anymore. You can't ship anymore. You got to shut all this down. You can't have in-person workers anymore. Then those corporations obviously are going to lose money. So we printed, I don't know, a couple trillion dollars, and we just tried to pacify people that weren't making any money. Businesses were able to apply for all sorts of grants, which has now been called the biggest grift in American history. Something like $240 billion is just gone. People just applied for stuff and just got it. You want to talk about one of the biggest failures of the Trump administration? Just giving away free money to unaccountable people. However, I digress. When you sell a company that they have to shut down, that's obviously going to impact their bottom line. It's going to impact their profit. So when things come back online, plus there was a whole bunch of pent-up consumer demand. Y'all couldn't wait to get back out there and shop again and get out in the real world and go to, like, concerts and go to bars and be in crowded, packed conditions because we couldn't do it for so long. We missed each other. I think
that y'all missed me. We all missed each other very much a lot. Couldn't wait to get back out there and go into a bar where it's hot, sweaty, and it's a stranger just rubbing against you. Like, what are you doing, stranger? Stop that. You're very warm. I feel your heat. Businesses started charging more money because we had a bunch of money because nobody was really spending any money. The only thing we were buying was toilet paper and groceries. And so businesses started raising prices. And then we can easily blame inflation. Yes, of course, there was some inflation because whenever you inject that kind of cash into the economy, the dollar has less value because there's more of it. It's simple supply and demand. But corporations and companies wanted to take advantage of the fact that we were ready to get back out there in the world and spend money again. And then we have the increases in sales taxes here on top of whatever inflation is, on top of businesses, companies, corporations, restaurants, whatever the case may be, also raising their prices. And now you have the referendum where the property taxes are going to go up. Notices are going to start going out very, very soon for those of you that rent. When it comes to the African-American community, that's almost 80% of us. We are being squeezed. And what happens is, like Mitt Romney's philosophy back in 2012, we wanted to make the immigrants feel so uncomfortable here in this country that they would self-deport. When you raise the prices on things and people's salaries are not going up and minimum wage is not going up, then people will go somewhere else. You can't say black people and brown people and working class people and poor people get out. That's illegal. But what you can do is price them out. Make it so they can never afford a home. They'll never have an asset. They'll never have collateral. They'll never have equity. Squeeze them out. And eventually, they will leave. Let's talk to Francis. You're on 101.7 The Truth. How are you?
I'm good. I was just going to comment on, like, the referendum. I don't know. I think you're right when it comes to, like, a lot of young white liberals. Like, I think that there's almost a sense of, like, pity in some way of, like, we need to fund public schools to, yeah, like, help the poor black and brown children. But I also think another dynamic is, like, with so much polarization on a national level, there's kind of this narrative that charter schools and school choice and private schools are only being supported by, like, the far right and, like, the most evil conservatives. And so I think there's a lot of white people who, like you said, don't have children, and especially don't have children going to MPS, who think, oh, to be a liberal is to vote yes on this. And really, like, it's through listening to your show that I've realized, like, how much more of the black community is skeptical of this, because in my own bubble, how I grew up, I also had kind of that assumption for a long time. And it really took a lot of, like, listening to realize, like, if we keep throwing money at MPS, that's not going to fix it. So I just think that it's becoming an issue as well of, like, it's being associated with being a good liberal is to vote yes. And to vote no would be being, like, a Trumpist or an evil conservative.
Question for you, Francis, and thank you for your call, but I got a question for you before you go.
Yeah.
Do you know any Caucasian folks, yourself included, that have ever attended a private school, parochial school?
Yeah, I did, for example.
Perfect. So I'm glad you said that. So when black children and black parents want to send their kids to private schools, like you and many like you went to, it's a right-wing conservative conspiracy. But when you all go to private schools, your parents want the best education for you. How do you demonize something in these modern days and times? You liken it to something that's conservative, that's a Republican and Trumpy. When black children and black parents want the same education that folks like yourself and, you know, your friends and family, I'm sure, when we want the same education that you all want,
it gets demonized because private schools are the last bastion of segregation and defeats the purpose. If you keep all the black kids in the public schools, then the private schools, which are also protected by expensive tuition, can stay white.
Yeah, no, I agree. And that's why I now support school choice a lot more than I did in the past. But the interesting thing I will say is my parents are both white. They both support school choice, but they also voted yes on this.
You need to ask them why. In fact, have them call me. I'd love to chat with them.
Yeah, I don't know if they'll be willing to call in, but it's really interesting because there's also that kind of liberal, too, who, like, does support school choice, but then also thinks giving money to MPS will somehow, like, make those schools better. So I don't know. It's very odd. I'm also trying to figure out what happened, but yeah, I definitely support school choice for that reason, because I know my high school and my grade school became a lot more diverse once we had that, and I think that's the right thing to do. So I agree with you there.
Thank you, Frances. I appreciate your call.
Yeah, have a good day. Bye-bye. You
too. Bye-bye. So that confusion, okay, where, well, it doesn't make any sense. Well, I want to vote yes to support the public schools, but at the same time, I want to be able to send my kids to private schools, but I want those black children to have the best education. Stop! The best education is where white people send their kids to school. So why would you vote to increase your property taxes to fund something that you know is not properly educating black children? Now, there's going to be some of you that are just going to relegate this to, oh, the black parents are at fault and they're not involved with their kids, their education. And you know what? Maybe there is some of that, but you need to just, like, call yourself what you are. You're a racist. If you want to just blame black people on the failure of the institution in which we are relegated to put our children, if you just want to blame black, you're a racist. And that's fine because there's a lot of racists in this country. That's exactly what it is, because you are putting the problem on the people. That's like blaming a woman for her own sexual assault. You blame the system, you blame the institution, because it's always been the system and the institution that has stifled black progress. Y'all know that, but now all of a sudden, now it's black parents to blame. Shut up. Go vote for Trump. Go vote for RFK. Some of y'all are going to vote for RFK, which I'm amazed by. Everybody's worried about the fentanyl and the opioids and the heroines and all of the crisis. RFK is literally a junkie, but y'all want him to be president? You know you can't give the president the keys to the U.S., a junkie president, the keys to the Treasury. He'll go buy dope with, like, gold bars from Fort Knox. All right, that's enough of that. Don't get me on RFK, because he's an idiot and probably shooting up right now. And I have very bad sympathies. Oh, it's sad. But you can't be president. You can't shoot dope in the Oval Office. That's a terrible thing to do. Bill Clinton did a bad thing in the Oval Office, but, I mean, that's slightly more acceptable than doing smack. You're listening to The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 FM. Don't go anywhere. I'll be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
For the brave men and women of our United States military, it's been said, some gave all, but all gave some. Here at Tabak Law, we honor these sacrifices by working to ensure veterans receive the benefits they're entitled to. I'm Jim Brzezinski, partner and VA-accredited representative at Tabak Law. If you're a vet and have been wrongfully denied or feel that your condition was not properly evaluated by the VA, visit TabakAttorneys.com to set up a free evaluation. At Tabak Law, we fight for those who fought for us. Contact Tabak for the payback. TabakAttorneys.com.
Introducing your trusted partner for all your freight transportation needs, it is Out the Mud Hauling. From local to long distance hauls, they ensure seamless, timely deliveries for businesses nationwide. They offer a variety of services like cross docking, order fulfillment, debris removal, hazardous material handling, pallet storage, and much more. Whether you're a seasoned shipper or an aspiring entrepreneur, trust Out the Mud Hauling for all your trucking needs across the USA. Contact them today at 262-278-1595. Out the Mud Hauling.
It's time for Truth Takes, a thought-provoking commentary on the new 101.7 The Truth. Here is Tory Lowe with his truth.
This is a true story by Tori Lowe. A commotion unfolds as two women argue inside of a car. The situation escalates when one woman pleads with a bystander asking for help to remove another woman from her car. The bystander, confused and concerned, asks, "Who is this woman?" She explains that she took her to church but wants her out before something bad happens. An older man, apparently familiar with the situation, approaches and demands the young woman in the backseat to leave. He threatens to involve the police. The bystander asks the woman outside of the car what the woman in the backseat did. She mentions something involving a child. The bystander immediately knew it was serious. The older man heads into Walmart to call the police while the bystander calmly approaches the woman in the backseat. He offers her to take her home out of fear for the woman's safety. The woman agrees to leave the car, but chaos ensues when the woman who requested her removal starts acting even more erratically. The woman from the backseat starts screaming, prompting the bystander to act quickly. A passing male driver offers to take the woman home, and the bystander agrees. They recognize each other from past encounters, establishing a sense of trust. As the woman leaves with the Good Samaritan, the bystander wishes them well and exchanges sentiments with the Good Samaritan. The situation was resolved just as the police arrived. The bystander informs the police the issue has been resolved and bids them a blessed day.
This has been Truth Takes on the new 101.7 The Truth. Listen to the Tori Lowe Show weekdays from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m.
This Associated Bank Sports Update on 101.7 The Truth is powered by ESPN Milwaukee. I'm Alex Telez. No Dame Lillard, and the Bucks lose another at home after falling to the Grizzlies Wednesday night by a final score of 111-101. Brook Lopez finished with a team-high 25 points and 10 rebounds. They get the day off this Thursday as they are set to host the Toronto Raptors on Friday night. Tip-off is scheduled for 7 with coverage beginning over on 94.5 at 6:30. The Brewers lost their first game of the year Wednesday versus the Twins at home by a final score of 7-3. First baseman Rhys Hoskins hit his second home run of the year this year in the fourth. They get the day off this Thursday and pick it back up at home Friday versus Seattle Mariners. Freddie Peralta expected to take the mound for the Brewers versus Logan Gilbert. First pitch is scheduled for 7:10 with coverage beginning on WTMJ at 6:35. This sports update brought to you by Associated Bank, proudly supporting your hometown teams member, FDIC.
This is The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
So I have some competing information here, right? Because I want to look at the demographics of who the staff are of NPS, right? And so I've got, and like this information is like, it's polar opposite of each other. Both of these websites you would assume are credible. So when you do quote unquote research on the internet, you have an idea or you have a concept or you have a question and you Google the question, the idea or the concept, and you're going to get all sorts of information. It's not all going to be the same. Because you figure if you have a question, is the sky blue? Yes, the sky is blue, and here's why. You would think that if you have a simple question and you Google it or you research the question, all of the information that is true, that is honest, that is factual, it's all basically going to be different versions of the exact same thing, written at different times, written by different people, written in different styles. But if it's a simple question, it should lead you to a relatively simple answer. And so I want to know who the staff are, because I've long had this issue with. So in America, there are places, cities, towns, counties, whatever, that are majority white. Milwaukee County is majority white. There's 30 something percent people of color, all combined, maybe close to 40% in Milwaukee County, but it's still majority white county. Dane County, majority white. There's a whole bunch of counties. There's 3,100 counties in America. A large swath of them are majority Caucasian, okay? But there are other counties, especially in the South, that are majority black. population is overwhelmingly African American. Georgia is probably home, if I had to guess, probably home to more of those counties than anywhere else. Probably Georgia, Virginia, the real Virginia, not the West one. Maryland could be another state where there are majority Black African American counties. And within majority Black counties, you are going to have white people of various incomes and levels of education. It's just the population of this county happens to be majority Black. And within those majority Black counties, where you do still have Caucasian folks living and doing their thing and making delicious casseroles. I can't help it. I love a casserole. What do you want from me? I like something in a chafing dish that's bubbly when it comes out of the oven. There are schools within those majority Black counties where white people, of course, live. But I have not yet found a school in America, and it's a really weird thing to search for, where the majority of the teachers and the staff are Black and the student body is white. And on its face, you would say, well, Sherwin, that makes sense. Why would white parents want to send their kids to school with majority Black educators? It just doesn't make any sense. I would actually argue the opposite. I think that there's an awful lot that white people can learn about and from themselves and about and from Black people if we reverse the roles. Because one thing that I know for certain, after coming up in the Brown Deer school system, I'm talking kindergarten through graduating through high school, is I know white people real good. I know their habits, traditions, cultures, religions, their routines, what they eat, how they eat it, what they value, what they dislike. I've seen it my entire life. In fact, it was the background music that was playing in my developmental years. So I've seen it. I've learned a lot about them. And I also learned that white people individually are as unique as anybody else. So are Black people. But it's easy to lump folks together and to stereotype folks if you don't have experience with who they are, what they like, what they hate, what they value, their routines, their goals, how they set their goals, their histories. If you don't know any of that stuff, if you haven't gotten to know people, then you're just going to stereotype them as one thing or another. And so I think there's a lot that could be learned if there was a school with majority Black teachers, staff, administrators, and a majority white student body. You would probably have a cohort of the least racist Caucasian people you ever could find. Because here's what's crazy. During the antebellum times, we took care of their kids. We raised their kids like they were ours. And they grew up to be, well, racist. But at one point in time, we were entrusted to raise their children. Here's something about the antebellum period that I cannot understand. I'm so confused by this. I wish I could go back in history and just look at what was happening. Because we try to like romanticize and fantasize about what history was like and what slavery was like. We have no idea. We have no clue. We can just read about it and, you know, try and dramatize it, or we have it in a movie or something, but we don't know what it was actually like. Here's the one part about the antebellum. Well, there's several parts I don't get, but the one that's just baffling to me, they would have Black women nursing white children, and it was normal. If you believe that Africans are inferior, and it was common, the mammy, the Black woman who would take care of the house, and this is even after slavery, because most Black women in the Jim Crow years, the early 1900s through the 1920s, were domestics. They worked, they took care of people's houses. They were servants, essentially. And they were nannies. And they took care of white children. Isn't that just baffling that you would allow that these racist white people that see Black people as like completely inferior, like subhuman, but would encourage and appreciate the mammy, this Black woman house servant, nursing their children? But there is a history of Black women and Black men on and off the plantation taking care of and protecting white children. But when it comes to education, no way, no how. So you know how I have not found, it doesn't mean they don't exist, any majority Black cities and counties where the schools are majority black, just reflective of the demographics of the county, which wouldn't be far-fetched, where you have majority black population in the county, majority black teachers and administrators in the schools, but a majority white student body. If you flip the script, that's common. Where we have, even in a city that is now 39% black, 38% white, the majority of the teachers and administrators at MPS are not just white, but they are white women. And that's perfectly normal. In fact, we need to give like battle pay to these white women teachers and administrators that work in the public schools. It's really them asking for the money. When white women ask for stuff, they get it unless it's the right to choose. Ain't that crazy? It seems like white women are trying to get whatever they can from whoever they can get it from. They can't make their own healthcare decisions. Now, can they? Now, black women can't either. But I need you to know that the overturning of Roe was not about black and Hispanic women and Asian women. You know that, right? We can't go on in this radio journey if you don't know that it wasn't about brown women having abortions, because if it was only brown women having abortions, abortions would be free and legal and available everywhere. White women, because white people are losing their population. And you may have a scenario where you have a majority black town with majority black schools and teachers and administrators in those schools and a majority white student body. You may have that, and that's a terrible fear. So you have to wonder, what is it about letting white women, who are the majority, and I got the statistics here, but they're competing. I got MPS's statistics on what their demographics are, and then I have an outside data organization, corporation that does nothing but compile data. They tell a different picture of who the actual staff people are that work at MPS, and they're drastically different. And so I asked someone that I know that is very familiar with MPS and MPS data to try and compile something for me. So hopefully I can reconcile what these numbers are. But it is staggering to me the lack of diversity, even if the MPS numbers, which seem more diverse, are true, the staggering lack of diversity in African-American teachers. Do you guys think that if MPS, humor me for a second, then I'm going to take a break. I'm going to leave you something to chew on while the commercials and the truth takes play. If MPS was majority, but like 99% black students and 99% black teachers, principals, administrators, safety staff, kitchen staff. Imagine MPS is a black district. Everybody black. Ain't no white women nowhere near MPS. They all went to go teach at St. Joan Antietam. They all went, all the white women teachers all went somewhere else. And MPS was all black. All black students, all black staff, all black principals. Do you think that they could ask for $252 million? Do you think that a majority black, I mean, more than just a superintendent, the board would be black, all the teachers are black, all the administrators are black, all the principals are black. Do you think a black school system could ask City of Milwaukee taxpayers for $250 million? Hell no. Not in a million. Do what you can with the money that you have. They would never give it to us. But because you got a majority of white women that are in those schools, that are running those schools, that are ministering those schools, and other principals, they get to ask for money and they get it. Chew on that. I'm going to take a break. Come back to you in a second. The Truth with Sherwin Hughes will be back in a couple of minutes.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 1017 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
The baseball season is finally here, and we want to celebrate the Milwaukee Brewers with you, Truth Nation. We are excited to announce our Take Me Out to the Ball Game giveaway. From now through the end of April, we will be giving away tickets to cheer on the Brewers live from American Family Field. For your chance to win a pair of tickets to a game, you must download the 1017 The Truth app and be on the lookout for our weekly Brewers Push notification. Play ball with The Truth and go watch The Brew Crew by downloading the 1017 The Truth app today. For contest rules, visit 1017thetruth.com.
This is Community Heartbeat, presented by Outreach Community Health Centers on 1017 The Truth.
There are individuals in our community who certainly need health services, a variety of health services. What if they do not have health insurance? How can you serve that population?
Our community health center allows patients to come to our clinic regardless of their ability to pay, and that's part of our federal funding. You can come to our clinic and be seen based on what we call a poverty level. So anyone 200% or below a poverty level can be seen in our clinic. clinic for anywhere from $20 to $40 for that visit. So, in other words, if your visit is a $400 visit and you fall on our sliding scale where you pay $20 for your visit, you would not be responsible for the $400. You'd only be responsible for $20 for that visit. Also, our pharmacy prescriptions are very, very affordable as well. Where you would normally pay, let's say for an inhaler, $240 a month for an inhaler, at our facility, that would cost you about $4 or $5.
It's very good to know you guys have a sliding scale that makes it very, very affordable.
Truth Nation, it's a big week for First Stage. The classic book series is coming to a live stage near you. Diary of a Wimpy Kid musical is coming to life at the First Stage Children's Theater in downtown Milwaukee. Bring the family to see this classic book turned into a musical by visiting firststage.com. The show runs at Marcus Performing Arts Center from April 6th to May 5th. Get your tickets today to see the Diary of a Wimpy Kid musical by visiting firststage.com for tickets.
Saving energy and money is easier than you think. Here are two simple things you can do to reduce your energy use and lower your energy bill. Use thermal curtains to reduce each room's energy loss by up to 25%, and make sure vents aren't blocked by furniture or rugs to improve airflow and comfort. Simple, smart savings. Get more energy saving tips at weenergies.com.
Happy Financial Literacy Month from Educators Credit Union. If you're dreaming of financial freedom, new ways to pay down debt, or tips to invest in your future, Educators Credit Union can help. They offer budgeting tools, personal finance courses, and debt solutions to turn your financial dreams into reality. Learn more at ecu.com. That is ecu.com. Membership at Educators Credit Union is open to anyone who lives or works in southeastern Wisconsin, and they are federally insured by NCUA.
It's the Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
All right, the workforce profile, and this is on the NPS website, says Milwaukee Public Schools employs 8,593 individuals. The workforce is predominantly female at 74%.
Was this referendum just women asking for more money?
That's one way to look at it. The ethnic slash racial demographics of the NPS workforce are as follows. 0.6% Native American, 2% Asian, 35.2% Black, 12.1% Hispanic, 1.7% not specified, 0.8% two or more races, and 47.6% white. So if I add the white and the Hispanic, you're looking at basically 60% non-Black and 35% Black. But the student body is what? What's the NPS student body racially? I probably should look it up. Probably 70% Black, right? So you have a mismatch there. So that's what NPS says on their website. Then I go to another website that does nothing but compile statistics called Zapia. And it says Milwaukee Public Schools Demographic Summary. Zapia estimates demographics and statistics for Milwaukee Public Schools by using a database of 30 million profiles. Our estimates are verified by the Bureau of Labor Statistics, the U.S. Census, current job openings, and other data for accuracy, blah, blah, blah. And they say, and so they have a little bit of a difference in the number of employees. So NPS says they have 8,593 employees. Zapia says that NPS has 8,896. Zapia says 68% of Milwaukee Public School employees are women and 32% are men. The most common ethnicity at Milwaukee Public Schools is white at 74%. So they're saying that NPS is 74%. White, 11% Hispanic, 7% Asian. I don't know which one to believe. Let's talk to Annie. You're on 101.7 The Truth. How are you, Annie?
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for letting me on.
Sure.
Hi. No, I've been listening to what you were saying, and I think in a roundabout way, I think you've answered your own question. How could the Upper East Side white liberal and the Upper West Side white liberal, most educated demographic in the city, vote before this referendum? I would speculate to say that a lot of those people who live in those neighborhoods are also employees of MPS, or they have spouses or children who are employees of MPS.
That would make sense.
I mean, because when you think about, I mean, in regards to teachers, yes, I used to be in education. I come from an education family, and I do think that educators should receive a cost of living raise and comprehensive benefits. However, you know, most of those administrators that you had mentioned, you know, they're not only are their salaries available for public record. You can look on the internet at any given time and see how much any administrator at MPS is making from year to year. You know, and most of those administrators make six-figure salaries.
Oh, yes, they
do. So they can afford to live. Yeah. They can afford to live on the east side, the upper east side, or in Washington Highlands.
Annie, you are no longer a teacher? Are you not an educator anymore?
No.
Okay. Did you retire?
Oh, no. I changed fields.
Okay. Are you from Milwaukee? Born and raised?
Yes. I was raised in Milwaukee, yes.
Okay. Did you go to school in Milwaukee?
Yes, I did.
What schools did you go to, elementary, middle, and high school?
Oh, okay. I was a part of the experiment, so I did go, you know, I went to the schools in the Mapledale Indian Hill School District.
That's River Hills.
And then for high school, Nicolay School District.
Okay, so you went to public schools, but not Milwaukee public schools.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you, Annie. I appreciate your call.
All right, thank you for having me.
All right, Annie. The Truth with Sherwin Hughes will be back for hour two.
1017 The Truth and Associated Bank have teamed up for our Black-owned business give back. Each quarter, we'll be giving away $6,000 worth of free commercial advertising for 3 months to 5 Black businesses. To sign up for your business's chance to win $6,000 of commercial campaign marketing on the award-winning 1017 The Truth, visit blackbusinessgiveback.com. That's blackbusinessgiveback.com. Let's rebuild our community's backbone through exposure on The Truth. For official rules, head to blackbusinessgiveback.com. Associated Bank, member FDIC.
Truth Nation, Dr. Ken Harris here, and I'm excited about the Truth partnership with Versity. There is a serious need for blood donations in the Black community, and Versity wants to bring awareness to this because it's their mission to improve patient outcomes, advance the field of personalized medicine, and strengthen the health of communities everywhere. This is why you should tune in every month when a representative from Versity joins the Truth to share about what they're doing to make a difference in our community.
My name is Ariel. When I arrived in the U.S. at 19, I struggled to find job opportunities without my high school diploma. My entire life changed when I took a chance and got my high school diploma at age 22. Everything I have, my education, my career, my marriage, I owe to the Adult Literacy Center and my teachers. They were with me every step of the way, helping with my English and math, making sure I pushed through all the challenges.
Ariel, your success proves that what I'm doing as a teacher has real meaning.
It was an honor helping you achieve your greatness. Now you're helping others achieve theirs. It inspires me.
Education was the key that unlocked all my opportunities.
When you graduate, they graduate. Find free and supportive adult education centers near you at finishyourdiploma.org. Brought to you by Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ad Council.
I'm Shanola Hampton. Every day, millions of people face hunger. Today, I will share with you some of their experiences. I'm stuck between paying for medications or paying for food. John from Maine. After paying my bills, I can buy groceries. It's sad to say, food comes last. Alice from Oregon. I thought pantries were for less fortunate people. But anybody could be less fortunate in a day or even a second. Claire from Virginia. The Feeding America network of food banks helps provide over 6 billion meals to people in need each year. No one should have to worry where their next meal will come from. Together, we can end hunger. Learn more at feedingamerica.org.
Listen to the home of the 5K Gruber Cash Giveaway. 1017 FM, 1510 AM WGKB Waukesha and W269DL Milwaukee, a locally owned Good Karma brand station.
This is The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 1017 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Welcome to Hour 2 of The Truth of Sherwin Hughes. Whenever I want to see experiments in democracy, I always look at California. What's California doing? And a lot of us Midwestern folks, we have our preconceived notions and ideas about California. But California is like, they lead in a bunch of stuff. Like California tries stuff 30 years before the rest of the country even wakes up. Something about the political ethos of California. And I don't know if the influence is Northern California and Oakland and San Francisco and Sacramento, which is the state capital, or is it Southern California where you got Orange County and Long Beach and L.A. and San Diego, Mission Viejo, et cetera, et cetera. I don't know where the predominant influence is. And Wisconsin, I would say Milwaukee is not of predominant political influence. Milwaukee has been othered by the rest of the state. If anything, Madison has more political influence in this state than we do, which is a shame, but I think you know why that is. Don't the big cities in a state, think of a state that just has one big city. That is where the influence is. The political influence, where the businesses are, it's where the money is. Money is distributed pretty well throughout Wisconsin. Now, there's some rich people in Milwaukee, of course. We've got a neighborhood, a couple neighborhoods of very wealthy people. But there's a bunch of rich people in Madison, too. A bunch of rich people way up north in Bayfield and Douglas County and Iron County and near the Lac du Flambeau Native Americans. There's rich people all throughout Wisconsin. But you would think that Milwaukee would have much more political influence and policy influence. And like what we discuss here in Wisconsin, you would think would be the predominant issues of Milwaukee. Because if we have more population here, and we know that more people come to Milwaukee for fun, for music festivals, for the Brewers games and the Bucks games. And we have a soccer team, I think. We have people that play hockey. We have a bunch of restaurants here. You would think that what Milwaukee says goes, because we are the business corporation portion of the state of Wisconsin. But that doesn't happen. Because if you made the issues of Milwaukee the issues of the state, we'd be talking about race, class, culture, poverty, low levels of education. So it's really, really weird how that works. But I go to California. I got to look at other places because we don't exist in a bubble. I also think that Wisconsinites believe that we are way more important than we actually are in the grand scheme of things. We are still considered flyover country. Nobody really comes for Wisconsin. Nobody checks on us. We hope the Packers do well. And we hope the Bucks do well because that's the kind of stuff that puts us on the map. Other than that, if we take those sports teams away, take away the Brewers, the Bucks, and the Packers, and Wisconsin is Iowa. Or even worse, Wisconsin would just be like another Dakota. Why we have two Dakotas? Don't know. Don't even know why we need one Dakota, but it is what it is. So we're not really all that significant. But because of the Electoral College, we have a grand sense of political self because we are like 1.9% of the nation's population, but we're like 4% of the Electoral College. So in a presidential contest, Wisconsin becomes important. The state of Wisconsin, not necessarily the city of Milwaukee. The city of Milwaukee is used to harvest Black Democratic votes. And see, I get it now. I don't want y'all to think that I never got it. I get it. I really do. Now I can better articulate it. we are expected, without question, without any critical thinking, to vote for the Democrats, no matter what, no matter what they're doing. Now, it makes sense because the Republican Party has gone full-blown fascism. Because they're trying to kill us, actually. The Democrats just have us on life support. They're not trying. They're trying to keep us alive just long enough to vote, and then we can die. Like the kids in NPS, they want to keep them in school just long enough so they can count them on the third Friday, then they expel them. You see what I mean? How they treat us? So we're not, the problems that we have here are not unique. It's racial. It is racial. Some of the most racist people I've ever met my entire life have been here. And my family is from the South. And up here, oh, it's just, oh, there's so many examples. So I look at other places. They might be dealing with a travesty, a tragedy, trauma, or a crisis. And what are other states doing? What's California doing? California, so when it comes to the environment, like California had car emission standards like back in the 70s. This thing called California emissions because they had an issue with smog and all sorts of other stuff. So they were much more politically focused and policy focused on the environment before any of us were. Not to mention California legalized marijuana. I think it was Proposition, either Proposition 8 or Proposition 215 in 1996. How many years ago is that? That's almost 30 years ago. So California has been way ahead of the curve. So where there is something major, something substantial that is lacking that we all know can help improve the educational outcomes of children, we need black teachers. For some reason, y'all keep telling black men and black boys to be plumbers and to be welders and to be carpenters and to do the heating and the ventilation and the air conditioning. That's what you're telling black men to do. And what black men are actually doing is either we're podcasting or rapping. So there's a disconnect right there too. But why aren't we telling black men to be teachers? There was a statistic that I read. And I read it every now and again. I think I shared it with you maybe a couple of weeks ago. Just the presence of one black teacher improves a black child's chances of graduating from high school. Just having one black teacher at some point, a black male teacher, let me say, improves a black child's chances of graduating like by 30%+. I'm sure some of y'all will look it up, but it's committed to my memory. There's a measurable and substantial improvement in that child's graduation rate by having a single black teacher. So you would think, why don't we get more black teachers? I also could probably correlate that if a black child has nothing but white teachers and white women teachers, they're going to be more likely to be suspended, expelled, have behavioral infractions, and not likely to graduate, and also probably do worse on test scores. What if black children are allergic to white lady teachers? Would that change anything? Probably not. So let me go to Ed's source here and see what's going on in California. Are they doing better than the rest of the nation when it comes to educating black children, and do they have more black teachers? Patrina Miller remembers as a young teacher in Los Angeles Unified School District, helping another teacher during testing and noticing that the teacher was giving black students and other students of color the answers to the questions. Miller asked why she was doing that. Let them have a productive struggle, Miller said. Let them try, and whatever score they get is what they get, and that's fine. The teacher said, poor little babies, they don't know any better. In a way, that made Miller very uncomfortable. On another day, the same teacher used a racist term to refer to Miller, who, of course, is black. The incidents were reported to the principal, but the teacher continued to work at the school. Miller isn't sure if she was even disciplined. California and other states have been trying to recruit and retain black teachers for years, but the numbers are not improving. Among the factors impeding the goal, along with the cost of teacher preparation, is a lack of support and respect for black teachers once they are in the classroom, according to teachers. So, you know, Posley had said recently, like, we're not saying we're not going to ask for more money. So they're going to ask for another referendum. Aisha Carr told us probably next 3, 4, maybe 5 years. It's going to fail. In fact, by then, NPS will probably be broken up into smaller districts, which it should have been a long time ago. If we had a majority of black teachers in the classroom at NPS and a majority of black administrators, please close your eyes and imagine this. It was the black school district. Like David Gruber is the black people's accident lawyer. He is. Come on, everybody. He totally. David Gruber loves black people. What if MPS was the black district? All the teachers were black. All the principals were black. All the staff, all the support staff, all the paras, all the lunchroom staff. Well, we have a lunchroom staff person that works for MPS that is a participant in my program. Dion the non-voter is a lunch lady at MPS. Even though he's bald, he still wears a hairnet. Don't ask me why. Do you think that a majority black student body, a majority black teachers, administrators, principals, staff, support staff could ask Milwaukeeans for $252 million and get it? When do black people ever ask for anything and get it? Doesn't happen. California and other states have been trying to recruit and retain black teachers for years, but the numbers are not improving. Among the factors impeding the goal, along with the cost of teacher prep, is a lack of support and respect for black teachers once they're in the classroom, according to the teachers. California can't get black teachers. If they legalized marijuana in the 20th century, and if you can't retain black teachers, then there's a problem here. And I would reckon the problem that exists in California and the issue that they are having retaining black teachers. Now, remember, black teachers help black children succeed. Just the presence of a black, especially male teacher, dramatically and drastically improves a black child's chances for graduation. Why wouldn't MPS do that? Why wouldn't MPS put a concerted effort? Because you know they got a teacher shortage. Last year, they had to hire 157 teachers from other countries. And they go over here and threaten us, saying, oh, we're going to have to lay off teachers. Oh, no, you're not, you silly pants. You can't lay off people in a shortage. That's counterintuitive. Quote, black teachers leave the profession of teaching because they don't feel supported for what they are able to bring to the table in terms of their unique experiences. And they leave because of the fact that they are not seen as equal to their white colleagues. Brenda Walker said that she's a black teacher who was president of the Associated Chino Teachers. Chino is a school district in Southern California. In the 2020-2021 school year, the most recent data available, 3.8% of all teachers in California were black, according to the National Center for Education Statistics. Black students made up 5.2% of the state student population that year, according to the California Department of Education. The state is doing better than the nation as a whole. Just over 6% of U.S. teachers were black in the 2021-22 school year. 1.3% of U.S. teachers were black men. Black students make up 15% of students. The number of black teachers in the United States has been declining for years. A growing body of research shows that having a teacher of color in the classroom is important to students of color, resulting in higher test scores and a greater likelihood of graduating from college. Research also shows that having black teachers in the classroom has a positive impact on all students, regardless of their race, said Travis Bristol, an associate professor of education at UC Berkeley, who has done extensive research on the topic. If we had majority black teachers at MPS, they wouldn't get any money. They'd probably cut funding. The first hurdle for potential black teachers comes early when they are still students in K-12 schools, Bristol said. We suspend and expel a disproportionate number of black children, he said. There is evidence, there's research, that if you are suspended and expelled, it decreases the likelihood that you will move on to pursue a higher education. Bingo. 80% of the students that have been suspended from MPS at 16,000 are black. If you usher that kind of discipline for children, you lessen the likelihood that they're going to move on to higher education. I need you to understand something about this country. The sympathy that they pretend to have for black people and for black children is either a veneer or it's false. Because remember all the George Floyd white people? Where have they gone? Did they go back to planet Zarkon? Because I used to think they loved us. Or they felt genuinely bad and it would be a major sea change in behavior toward African Americans. Y'all don't even remember George Floyd no more. George Floyd was like a fever dream. George Floyd was like something that just happened during COVID. And then COVID is over and then that whole sentiment of Black Lives Matter all went out the window.
The cost of teacher preparation is a major roadblock to a credential. Tuition, the cost of required tests, and unpaid student teaching have kept many black people out of their profession, according to teachers interviewed by edsource.org. I'm going to take a break, come back, pick it up there. So why isn't there more of a concerted recruitment? And also, why isn't our community, even though there's the suspensions and there's the expulsions, which we know lessens the likelihood that black children will pursue higher education, but we're still telling black men to pursue higher education, become a welder or a plumber or a carpenter or do the HVN, the AC. Why not encourage us to be educators? Because the outcomes will not only be better, the discipline problems will improve. I guarantee you, you'll see less suspensions. You'll see less expulsions. I guarantee you'll see test scores go up. But that's not the point, ladies and gentlemen. That's not the point. The point is not to educate black children. It's to keep them corralled so that you can control their very fate. You are listening to The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 FM. I'll be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
What's good, y'all? This is 101.7 The Truth's Telly Hughes, and I am Milwaukee. The goal of Truth Be Told with DT and Telly is to provide a platform for citizens of Milwaukee and Truth Nation to have their voices heard about concerns that have daily direct impact. So join the home of Milwaukee's realest conversations where you can speak your truth. We are the award-winning 101.7 The Truth, Milwaukee Black Talk.
The Empowerment Small Business Loan Program, we're talking about up to $5 million, which for small business owners, we need that. That's like payroll, that's resources. So can you just let us know, what is the program and why is this lending program so important to Old National Bank?
Years ago, our CEO, Jim Ryan, this program is his brainchild. He was working with Roland Shelton, who you know, Denise, out of Evansville. And they identified that African-American business owners, Hispanic business owners, Native American business owners, as well as women business owners, had a difficult time in obtaining financing from the traditional credit partners. And so we went out, created a program, launched it last year, 2023. And so far last year, we have helped over 100 successful minority and women-owned businesses with about $25 million in loans. We've already started this year with almost $8 million in approvals, again, geared toward minority business owners and women business owners that normally had difficulties in obtaining traditional credit finance.
We Energies want you to keep this important safety message in mind. Before you start digging, planting, or landscaping on your property, call 811 to have underground utilities marked. Calling 811 at least 3 business days before you plan to dig will help you know what's below and can prevent a hazardous situation. Our representatives will mark the underground utilities on your property for free. So remember, stay safe and call before you dig.
We Energies, people you can trust, energy you can depend on.
Protect your dream home with American Family Insurance. And you can weather any storm. You'll also save up to 25% by bundling home, auto, and life. American Family Insurance. Get a quote. Find an agent at amfam.com.
Products not available in every state. Discounts may not apply to all coverages on an auto or home policy. Discounts do not apply to life insurance policies. Visit amfam.com to learn how discounts may apply to you. American Family Mutual Insurance Company, S.I. and its operating companies, American Family Life Insurance Company, 6000 American Parkway, Madison, Wisconsin.
It's The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Black teachers owe an average of $43,000 more in college debt than white graduates, and that's 12 years after graduation, according to the Learning Policy Institute, a nonprofit education research organization. The low salary of new teachers and the high amount of college debt associated with 5 years of college can dissuade black people from becoming teachers. Many also aren't financially able to quit their jobs to complete the 600 hours of unpaid student teaching required to complete the necessary credential. I've been trying to tell y'all that student loan forgiveness is a black policy. Some of y'all that didn't go to college, or those of you, not many of you, that paid off your student loans, you don't see it that way. Just like Obamacare was a black policy. You can't say, hey, black people, I want to help you because I'm a
I'm a Democrat and I want to help the blacks because, you know, black people vote for Democrats, whatever. They got to be more covert because there's people called Republicans and rednecks and bigots and people in the South that would be really angry because they'd be like, hey, we're poor too. We need help. Why is you helping the black people? If you're white and poor, you're lazy. No, I'm serious. Like, what's your excuse? What is the excuse for Caucasian poverty? I'm not racist. I'm being objective here. I'm wearing a journalism hat. If you look on YouTube, it says journalism on my hat. What's the excuse for white poverty? Okay, so think of what it is. I don't know, a woman was married to a man, she didn't work, he died, he didn't have any money, he didn't leave her with anything. What are the excuses for white poverty? Okay, now think of the excuses for black poverty. Oh, you get flooded with responses, don't you? Well, blacks are lazy. They don't want to work. They're bad employees. They drop out of school. They don't go to college. They don't apply themselves. They don't save their money. Oh, and they have so many kids. You see how that goes? Think of the excuses for why a black person is poor or struggling or not making it, okay? It's what comes to mind. So those, I need you to listen to me now. Those things that immediately come to mind when you ask yourself why a black person is poor is racism. Because do those same exact things come to mind when I ask the question, why is a white person poor? If a white person is poor, oh my God, they fell on hard times. What can we do to help them? I know what we can do to help them. Literally create the welfare system. You think the welfare system was created because there was black poverty? You're nuts. You should have your citizenship revoked if you think that. There is no way that this government, especially back then, would create a food benefit, a heating assistance benefit, a rent assistance benefit, any kind of benefit because of poor black people. Now, here's the thing. We qualified for it because there's an application and you can't bar us from qualifying for a government program because that's the worst kind of discrimination you see. But I have to every now and again give people these little examples of racism because y'all will be over here thinking that it doesn't exist. The things that come to mind like naturally, automatically when I ask you about black poverty. It's ineptitude on the black people. They didn't do enough. They were supposed to do more. They didn't apply themselves in schools. But what if the schools that they didn't apply themselves in, those schools were not applying themselves to black children? What if that is where they are creating the trajectory of our poverty? And then they blame us for the poverty. And what do a lot of black folks do? We mimic it. So what is the reason why a white person can be poor? I don't even think I know any reasons why. I know that my first, like, understanding of poverty didn't come from black people. When I went to Brown Deer, my parents moved to Brown Deer in 1980 because they were just starting to allow African-American families to move into Brown Deer. Even though the legislation had passed, I think fair housing was 1968. It takes a long time, right? Just because something is made illegal at the federal level doesn't mean that local units of government and localities are going to automatically straighten up and fly right. It takes a while. But the amount of down payment that you had to have, the amount of credit you had to have in the early 1980s and late 1970s to be black and get a house in Brown Deer was way more, a higher bar, a higher requirement than a white person, because it was also classist as well. They didn't just want working class black folks living in Brown Deer. They wanted folks who had means, black folks with means, because they would be less of a problem. They would be less trouble. They would do less erosion of whatever the cultural fabric was of Brown Deer at the time, you see. So my parents bought a house north of Brown Deer Road, which at the time was the cool part. But these white kids that I went to school with would wear the same clothes to school every day. Their hair was disheveled. Oh, and not to mention their shoes. They packed the same cold lunch every day because they couldn't afford hot lunch. So I was like ingratiated and indoctrinated in white poverty. But I didn't make up excuses for it. I was just like, oh, just the whites don't have shoes to wear and clothing. So my situation is, in my perspective, is reversed. It's very, very different because I saw poor white people all the time. Brown Deer was a working class suburb, quite honestly.
especially south of Brown Deer Road. Those houses are tiny, little matchboxes. Now they're $250,000 now, but back then those houses were $40,000 if they were a penny.
But what are the excuses for it?
Why are white people poor? Somebody has a gambling addiction or something? Is this Eileen? Eileen is online. Well, let's talk to Eileen. Hello, Eileen. How are you doing?
Good morning, Sherwin. I just had an epiphany about why there aren't enough black teachers.
Oh, okay. This will be great.
But think about the experience of black kids going to school with white teachers.
Yeah,
so you think about, like, people who are coming, you know, white kids that had a really good experience with a nurturing teacher wants to get into the profession because they have a good experience with it. How many black kids with white teachers could say the same?
You're right. And the statistics and data say the exact same thing. So then tell the white teachers to act better.
Say that again. I was what?
The statistics and the data say the exact same thing, so maybe we need to tell white teachers to be nicer to black kids. Eileen, go and tell your people to be nicer to the black children.
Hey, you know what? I lead by example. And so really, you know, one of the things that I'm taking up right now with a school board director is getting a hoop at High Mount Speed Bump School.
Oh.
Because there is not a basketball hoop there. Well, the one that they have there is from 1930. And it is literally a piece of plywood and a hoop that, oh, wait for it, they take down at the end of the day. And so we have been working feverishly. Like, me and my husband, we supply the hoop there. We roll over a portable hoop and beg for forgiveness later so that kids in our immediate neighborhood who are black can actually have a safe space to play. And that MPS hasn't figured out. They can put a hoop, they can put a hoop at Niskara, they can put a hoop in Tosa, they can't put a hoop here? What's wrong with that? So as soon as that referendum passed yesterday, I called Mr. Henry Leonard, school board director, and, you know, making him accountable. And let's make that happen so that kids that live in this immediate neighborhood have a safe space to play. So that's my piece.
Thank you, Eileen. Appreciate your call.
You're welcome.
All right. Somebody asked, so y'all are thinking class action lawsuits. Somebody said that in the text message comments. You can text us at 833-212-1017, 833-212-1017. And then I think someone also said it in the YouTube comment thread. So rent is going to go up. We was trying to tell y'all that. You know what's crazy? Let me tell you what's crazy. There's a lot of things that are crazy, but let me say this crazy thing specifically. I can only do so much 3 hours a day, 15 hours a week in warning you guys and telling you guys. But when the teachers union, which is a bunch of hacks, they say, oh, we're going to have to lay off teachers unless you vote for the referendum. Y'all believe that. But when Sherwin says they're going to raise your rent, no, they're not. And now some of y'all are starting to get the notices. Oh, the landlords had the notices already printed. Somebody said, oh, there's going to be a class action lawsuit if the rent goes up. No, there's not. Taxpayers can't sue each other. 1,720 people made the difference in some people being priced out of their homes and your rents going up and us increasing homelessness. Can you believe that? 1,720 people. I could have driven 1,720 people to go and vote. I drive a small car, but Get in the car. Get in there. But Sherwin, there's already four people in your car. Shut up. Get in the car. Somebody also brought up suing MPS or MPS needs to get sued. They have been. They have. They have been sued. This is from January 17th. Well, it was updated. I think the lawsuit goes back to 2015. The Obama administration sued MPS because the discipline, expulsion, and suspension rates at MPS were so bad. So bad. Listen to me. Listen what I'm finna tell you now. These are the people you just voted to give $250 million to. So the suspension
and expulsion rates and the discipline, the heavy-handed discipline on black children in MPS was so bad that the U.S. Department of Education sent up a red flag. Okay? They're like, yo, this, what's going on here? Nothing changed. Then our friend, like, he's our friend because he likes you guys too, but like, no, I got his cell phone number. Eric Holder, first black attorney general of the United States, the 84th attorney general of the United States. It took 83 until we got an actual black one. He sued, the federal government sued the U.S. attorney's office, sued MPS because of how they're disciplining black children. And guess who the superintendent was then? Darian Driver. Can I be clear about Darian Driver? She wasn't a nice lady you thought she was. She presented well. She was the face like Posley is. Oh, I know things about her and things that she said about my friends' wives and all. Oh, yeah. She's gone. She's out of here. Milwaukee Public Schools has entered into an agreement with the U.S. Department of Education's Office of Civil Rights to resolve a complaint that it discriminated against black students in suspensions and other disciplinary actions. Under the terms of the agreement, MPS must, among other things, improve its monitoring and data collection, better train staff, update its disciplinary policies, and develop early identification and intervention strategies for students at risk for behavior problems. This is similar to a consent decree that somebody else is under. Guess who that is? The Milwaukee Police Department. Isn't it crazy that the federal government has both our public school system and our police department under consent decree because of discrimination? At the time, Superintendent Darian Driver said she is, quote, confident MPS can reduce the racial disparities in discipline in the district, which has long been among the highest suspension rates in America for years. Quote, we have to. It's not optional, Driver said after Tuesday's meeting of the School Board Committee on Student Achievement and School Innovation, where she briefed members on the agreement. A number of initiatives we have in place are intended to address this, she said. It's everything from the Office of Black and Latino Male Achievement to mindfulness and the work we've been doing on implicit bias and building relationships. It all speaks to that. So either the MPS statistics are correct or the Zipia statistics are correct, where MPS is either 74% white or 47% white. White people perceive black child behavior as more threatening and more in need of discipline. That is why we have 80% of the suspension still right now to this day. And this is a decade after this consent decree went into effect. They haven't changed anything. The consent decree went into effect, I'm going to say 2015, right? Guess who got elected in 2016? You think that Trump was going to use his federal government to enforce a consent decree to require black children to be disciplined less harshly? Nope. All right, I'm going to take a break, come back and talk to Tasha. Our phone number is 833-212-1017, 833-212-1017. You are listening to The Truth with Sherwin Hughes. I'll be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 1017 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Happy Financial Literacy Month from Educators Credit Union. If you're dreaming of financial freedom, new ways to pay down debt, or tips to invest in your future, Educators Credit Union can help. They offer budgeting tools, personal finance courses, and debt solutions to turn your financial dreams into reality. Learn more at ecu.com. That is ecu.com. Membership at Educators Credit Union is open to anyone who lives or works in southeastern Wisconsin, and they are federally insured by NCUA.
Sharon needed legal help. She needed Gruber Law Offices.
When I think about Gruber Law Office, I think about how they took care of me, how they make sure that you get what you're supposed to get. Gruber Law Office. One call, that's all. I will always, always trust One Call, that's all.
Injured? Call Gruber Law Offices today. One call, that's all.
They are the best. I'm very happy.
Milwaukee's favorite station.
Please, please, Lisa, please, for the love of Jehovah, don't kick me or anybody with a prosthetic leg. Please. Why do I even gotta say please? Because what if you kick me and it falls off? I ain't gonna pick it up. You try to kick me. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna hit you with your own leg. I teach you a lesson.
Coming with straight truth.
And you know what? If you want to make it about race, I need you to hold your black men accountable. Don't let these black men get away with anything. Because what does that say about you? Because if you're going to be that person who's not going to hold your own people accountable, we have nothing to talk about. I'm sorry. That's the real old school mentality, my guy.
Tune in to all your favorite 101.7 The Truth shows all day, every day by downloading the Truth app.
We got
to
get back into common courtesy.
Mm-hmm. It's about the family structure.
Right. It is.
Our extended family, we are all family in Milwaukee. Come on now.
Watch all your favorite 101.7 The Truth shows by subscribing to 101.7 The Truth on YouTube.
Severe flooding from recent hurricanes and other storms has left hundreds of thousands of cars, trucks, and other vehicles unsafe to drive. Flooded vehicles are supposed to be dismantled for usable parts or crushed for scrap, and a flood title should be issued to that car. But some shady dealers will buy a flooded vehicle, clean it up, and get it retitled with no indication it was flooded. Or uninsured cars will be cleaned up by the owner and sold online, also with no warning to the buyer. If the price is too good to be true, it probably is. Make sure to check for flood damage and have a qualified mechanic inspect the vehicle before you write a check. The free VIN check service from the National Insurance Crime Bureau is a good place to start. Head over to NICB.org to check it out.
To report fraud, call us at 1-800-TELL-NICB. This is a public service message from the National Insurance Crime Bureau.
This is The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Our phone number is 833-212-1017, 833-212-1017. Let's talk to a patiently waiting Tasha. Hello, Tasha. How are you doing today?
Hello. How are you doing this morning?
I'm doing well, thank you. What's on your mind, Tasha?
Okay, the school system. It's a lot of problems with that school system, and I can go a million places, but I'll just go here. I'm an NPS kid from kindergarten to graduation. And I recently went to James Madison High School. That's where I graduated from. And it's crazy because it's all black kids and it's all white teachers. And my thing with that is they just said that black people, black women have spent more money in college and old than anyone else. So I'm pretty sure a lot of them were educators. I have some aunts that were educators. I don't think they don't give them the jobs, I would say, because they start these charter schools and then they hire their cousins and their friends. And a lot of them teachers don't have degrees or certificates or anything, but they're teaching our children and they call them charter schools and they're supposed to be better, but they don't be. They don't even, like, even when they help the kids, they're supposed to be helping them. They read it to them, so they hinder them. They don't help, they do it. So it's a difference if you're helping my child to read or if you're telling them to repeat after you or just basically doing their work. Because, see, I have some children that went through the system, and they were pushed through, and I was up there fighting. I had met up with Khalif Rainey and was questioning him, like, hey, the school's not doing good. And I can name a lot of them, you know, Destiny High School. What kind of high school is that? Okay, the teacher, at the time, the principal was a lady named Miss Reed. And she was more worried and concerned about high-fiving being kids' friends and getting into their gossips and arguments than actually educating them or being disciplinary or anything. So the problem is in the teachers. It's in the way how things are ran, you know. And why do you have an all-black school with all-white teachers?
When did you graduate from Madison, Tasha? What year did you graduate, if you don't mind me asking? Because that helps me put it in a concept of, like, because NPS used to be an all-white school district. Okay.
Yeah.
Were there still white kids?
And it was white kids there.
Okay.
It was white kids.
Because that was a white neighborhood.
We could smoke in the courtyard.
Tasha, is Madison off of Flores? Because I get that one mixed up with Marshall.
Yeah, it's off of Flores.
Okay. Gotcha. Yeah, that used to be an all-white neighborhood back in the day.
No, it was black people lived over there, too, because, my auntie had friends over there, and we would call ourselves Skip to School. So we would go past our house, their house was whispering because we didn't want to get caught.
Well, by the early 90s, a lot of the white folks had moved out. But, like, in the 80s, that neighborhood was still very – it was probably mixed. It was a working-class neighborhood. But there was a lot of white folks over there by Madison.
Okay.
Exactly. And I had a lot of white classmates, okay? So when I went in recently, I mean, not one white student. Not one white student. Only white people you see are authority figures. So all the white folks are in charge. Well, that's not a good look neither. Like, I heard the lady before, but my nephew, he say things like, go to your monster zone or something. They become the squirrely face or something where they tell him that's the way to calm down. And I sit in their classrooms. I went to Mitchell Elementary, and I was sitting in the classroom, and they have this new concept where the kids don't have to sit in a chair or pay attention. They can just lay on the floor.
Wait,
and
what?
Under the seats. And yeah. And you know, it was weird to me because I was sitting in the classroom. You know, I went to go check on my nephew. Sometimes he's a little naughty. So I went to the school. Now, he's in a white kid's school. So I went to the school to see, like, what are they teaching him? You know, why is he so naughty? Why is he all the time the bad child? He's a very big child for his age, but he's not really naughty to say. Sometimes he doesn't like to sit down and be still. That's his problem. So I go to see, you know, like, what goes on in the classroom and why. Well, for one, they don't demand that he be still. They don't demand that no child in the class be still. These babies was walking around the class, laying under the seats and going from seat to seat, tapping each other's head. The teacher was talking. And then, the other thing, too, like the teacher, he taps and he calls names. He calls children idiots. It was a white male. And I was appalled, okay?
Damn.
So I went to the principal, and I said to the principal, hey, how do you allow this? And they told me that this is the way things are now. And I didn't understand it. I really didn't understand it. And all the kids in the class were slow, and you wonder why.
And what school was this, Taja?
It was Mitchell. I want to say the name correct.
Okay.
What's the name of that school over there? General Mitchell. General Mitchell.
Is that an MPS school or is that a charter? What kind of school is that? I ain't never heard of no airport school.
General Mitchell is an MPS school, but I think, no, you know what? It's actually like Cudahy, St. Francis borderline around in that area.
Okay.
It's like off of Pennsylvania over there. But the concept in the classroom was so weird to me. I didn't, and when I came, they act like I was a bomber or something. I just was coming to have lunch with my nephew because, you know, I'm the auntie who will pop up and peek in your classroom. That's what my aunties did to me. You know, I'll come and have lunch with you or just possibly bring lunch to the whole class. But those people were not inviting. They were not welcoming. When I walked into school, they make it seem like I was a death threat. I sat in the class and paid attention. I didn't interrupt or say, hey, what are you doing? Why are you tapping that kid? Why are you calling them names? I didn't say a word. I just sat there. So I didn't even understand why they were so worked up about me being there, you know.
All right, Tasha. Well, I come to find out General Mitchell Elementary School is not in Milwaukee. It's in the suburb of Cudahy. So it's not.
And that's the thing, though. But they still have, like, these extra opportunities for their children. But, again, when we put our children in off-skirt schools, he's just being mistreated there.
All right, Tasha, I appreciate your call. This is another problem we got to worry about. Even when the children leave the district, they're still mistreated.
Right.
All right, be careful, Tasha. Okay. It's a siren now. You might need to hide. Now I got to go.
That's
all.
Okay, have a good one.
All right, Tasha. Tasha, the police coming for her. Let's see here. What is this? What year was this? 2018? Nope, 2019. Almost 70 years ago, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled the racial segregation of children in public schools was unconstitutional. That decision, for the first time, afforded black children access to the same educational opportunities as white children. Although many schools remain de facto racially segregated today, the decision is still heralded as one of the country's most significant milestones for civil rights. But Brown also had unintended consequences, the effects of which are still felt today.
It caused the dismissal, demotion, or forced resignation of many experienced, highly credentialed black educators who staffed black-only schools. After the decision, tens of thousands of black teachers and principals lost their jobs as white superintendents began to integrate schools, but balked at putting black educators in positions of authority over white teachers or students. So there was a time, and a lot of you are very fond of this time, when you went to wherever you went to school, but you had black teachers. Then Brown versus Board of Education comes, like, now we can't segregate schools anymore, because what we probably didn't know is that while there were black students and black teachers, black administrators in those schools that were teaching black children, they were doing so with a lot less money. But here's the thing with black folks. We don't need as much money as whites do. You give us just a little bit of money, a little bit of opportunity, and we will make something magic happen with that. That's just a part of the mystique of being black. That and seasoning food. You give us a little bit, we'll make things happen with just a little bit. So when the schools were integrated and black children started going out and getting bussed out to suburban schools, what happened was those suburban schools, while they were accepting black children, they weren't accepting black teachers. So we lost an entire institution of black teachers that were teaching black kids, because back in the day, that was the only choice, because schools were segregated, meaning in segregated black schools, white teachers weren't coming in from the suburbs or other parts of the city to teach in black schools. It was black teachers, black administrators, black principals, and black children. And so when integration happened, we lost, this is what they estimate, $2 billion worth of income from black teachers, because they were not employed as teachers anymore. But we lost the institutional knowledge of black educators. So now we are a full generation, if not two generations, past Brown versus Board of Education. So we have two generations of black educators being few and far between. I'm going to take a break, come back, and talk to Tara on the other side. Tara wants to chime in and say things. If you want to be like Tara, Tasha, Francis, or other people that have called, you call 833-212-1017, 833-212-1017. I think I need to go into a classroom. I think I need to sit. The last classroom I sat in was Dr. Fuller's school, and that wasn't fair, because those children, those were the smartest kids I've ever seen. And that was a freshman English class that Dr. Fuller was teaching that day. And I felt so dumb that I had to reevaluate my life. These children are using the Socratic method in an English survey course for freshmen. I had to leave. I felt very disappointed in my... I wasn't that smart when I was 14. When I was 14, I looked at girls a lot. Like a lot. A lot. Ha! The truth was sure when he was to be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 101.7thetruth.com.
Truth Nation, join the Truth team on Saturday, April 13th for our third annual Tory Lowe Community Cleanup. We want you to go to truthcommunitycleanup.com to sign up and be a volunteer to help keep Milwaukee clean. Everyone who joins will get a free lunch provided by Cousin Subs. Register today at truthcommunitycleanup.com. That is truthcommunitycleanup.com to clean and beautify our city together. The Truth Community Cleanup is sponsored by Cousin Subs and Safe and Sound.
The Empowerment Small Business Loan Program, we're talking about up to $5 million. Which for small business owners, we need that. That's like payroll, that's resources. So can you just let us know, what is the program and why is this lending program so important to Old National Bank?
Years ago, our CEO, Jim Ryan, this program is his brainchild. He was working with Roland Shelton, who you know, Denise, out of Evansville. And they identified that African-American business owners, Hispanic business owners, Native American business owners, as well as women business owners, had a difficult time in obtaining financing from the traditional credit partners. And so we went out, created a program, launched it last year, 2023. And so far last year, we have helped over 100 successful minority and women-owned businesses with about $25 million in loans. We have already started this year with almost $8 million in approvals, again, geared toward minority business owners and women business owners that normally had difficulties in obtaining traditional credit finance.
When it comes to getting the smile of your dreams, you can't just trust anyone. So look no further than Bubon Orthodontics. Bubon Orthodontics is Wisconsin's number one Invisalign provider and has been providing the best value for braces and Invisalign since 1993. With 15 convenient locations, you're sure to find one in your area. Schedule your free consultation today. Call or text 262-522-7447 or visit bubonortho.com. Bubon Orthodontics, a family treating families.
Truth Nation, it's a big week for First Stage. The classic book series is coming to a live stage near you. Diary of a Wimpy Kid musical is coming to life at the First Stage Children's Theater in downtown Milwaukee. Bring the family to see this classic book turned into a musical by visiting firststage.com. The show runs at Marcus Performing Arts Center from April 6th to May 5th. Get your tickets today to see the Diary of a Wimpy Kid musical by visiting firststage.com for tickets.
Life's better with American Family Insurance because our home policies help protect your dreams and come with peace of mind. Save up to 25% by bundling home, auto, and life. American Family Insurance. Get a quote, find an agent at amfam.com.
Products not available in every state. Discounts may not apply to all coverages on an auto or home policy. Discounts do not apply to life insurance policies. Visit AmFam.com to learn how discounts may apply to you. American Family Mutual Insurance Company, S.I. and its operating companies, American Family Life Insurance Company, 6000 American Parkway, Madison, Wisconsin.
It's The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 1017 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Let's talk to Tara. Hi, Tara. Tara, Tara. Which do you prefer?
Both. Either or. It doesn't matter. It's the same thing.
What's on your mind, Tara, Tara?
Hi, I'm calling because I'm listening to this today about the schools, and I am in the process of looking for a new school for my small person because since returning back to Milwaukee, I did have her in a public school, and I absolutely refused to send her back. She was bullied incessantly, not only by the students, but by a teacher. And also the bus driver lied and said he came to the bus stop and I was not there. The school told him, no, that's not possible. She always calls when she gets there. Then he said, well, I don't have her on my bus. So fast forward, he said he was on his way home. He wasn't going back. And I told him he needed to get back so he could get my baby to me. He says, oh, I looked up and she's sitting in the back of the bus. That gave me red flags that you're a predator.
Whoa. So, what school was this, exactly, Tara? What school was it?
That school was Milwaukee Academy of Chinese Language. I put her in that school because I thought, hey, this is a good start. She'll learn a language. She learned three Chinese words. I could have used Duolingo and taught her more. So fast forward, I found a different school. She did really well in elementary, went on to middle school. She was bullied. I reported it. I talked to the principal. Not till seventh grade. She was bullied in seventh grade, and I talked to them. And nothing was really done. It kept going till it got to the point. So I went to the school, and I demanded a conference with the parents. And even then, one of the parents had the audacity to open her mouth and say, well, is your daughter in counseling? Because she looks a little sad. Would you be sad or would you be grinning from ear to ear if I bullied you and your son is bullying her? What do you mean? So the bullying did wind up stopping after some time, but I had to keep going to this school. But it was to the point where I told the children, if you don't stop bullying her, I'm going to bully your parents when I see them outside, when they come to pick you up. So she comes home. She's upset. She goes to class. She can't learn. The children are being disruptive. They're cussing each other out. They're cussing the teachers out. Oh, they get what is that called? Like pulling a card if they misbehave. Like the only time I've ever seen that was in kindergarten. These are middle school students. And they get a card pulled. I forgot what they call it. But and these kids don't care. Teachers have quit and left this school, and some have left crying. And it's mostly Hispanic. It's supposed to be a charter school. I'm not happy with it. I took her out for 2 months, and I homeschooled her for 2 months. She went back and she blew them away with her test scores when she got back. And I agree with Tasha. They're really not teaching them anything. She gets frustrated because the children are allowed to just act indignant and do whatever they want in this classroom, and teachers are barely able to reprimand them. I was assisting with the volleyball, and I said, okay, you need to come, and you need to wear your practice gear to practice, or you're going to do push-ups and run. You can't tell them that. They're not used to it. But this is a sport. That's called conditioning. So they no longer wanted me to assist with volleyball.
What school was this, Tara?
This is Carmen Middle School.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah, where is your child going to school now? Is she at Carmen right now? Did you put her back in Carmen?
She's still in Carmen because I applied at a different school, and there was a raffle. Is that what they call it?
Yeah, a lottery.
And she didn't make it in. So I'm trying again this year. Fingers crossed, but I'm still looking for a good school to put her in. I don't live on the north side. I live on the south side of Milwaukee. It's just so very hard because I want her to have a quality and a good education, but where do I send her? I used to work in the school district in Las Vegas. I came here and I was like, yeah, I could work in the school district out here. Oh, absolutely not. I don't look good behind bars. Some of these young people, they want to fight you. And they're disrespectful. They have no respect for authority. They barely have respect for each other. And it's really sad because to me, seemed like I was in culture shock because this didn't seem like the Milwaukee that I left. I left and went to the military back in 86. And But it's a lot different. I don't know. But
Tara, we got to leave it there. But I want you to keep us posted on what school you find. I got to take a break now. But thank you for sharing your story.
Okay, no problem.
All right.
Okay.
Tara, that was... So it's nothing but horror stories. Well, at least the horror stories coming out of the public education system is going to have $250 million more dollars to create more horror. The Truth with Sherwin Hughes. We'll be back for Hour 3.
From the biggest plays on the court to the comments made in the locker room after, an in-depth recap of every Bucks game in 6 minutes. No more, no less. Bucks in 6 provides game recaps for every game. Hear the high-flying dunks from Giannis.
Puts it on the floor, spins down the lane, and plunges it through.
Or the deep threes from Dame.
Dame time has arrived with 107.
Bucks in 6 on the Bucks Plus Audio Network. Find it now on bucks.com/plus or on Spotify, Apple, and wherever you get your podcasts.
Milwaukee, we are in the heart of the basketball season, and we have all the local hoops news you need to hear. Get your weekly smile on with our Nothing But the Truth basketball report, brought to you by Bubon Orthodontics. On Nothing But the Truth, we'll keep you in the loop on all the local Milwaukee hoops news, from high school all the way to the pros. So don't miss your shot to join in on the hoops talk by tuning into the Truth Basketball Report on Nothing But the Truth, right here on the new award-winning 101.7 The Truth, brought to you by Bubon Orthodontics, the official smile of the Milwaukee Bucks.
Being blind doesn't always look how others may think. Stargardt disease was supposed to define me.
Retinitis pigmentosa aimed to overwhelm my family.
It tried to cut me down. A blinding eye disease attempted to force me away from doing what I was born to do.
But it cannot stop me. I have the tools.
I will keep moving forward.
Pushing past the limits of this disability.
I know where to find support and where I can be seen.
Loss of sight won't blind our vision. Innovative research, educational resources,
supportive community. The Foundation Fighting Blindness is leading the charge in finding treatments and cures for blinding diseases. Learn more at fightingblindness.org. A public service message from the Foundation Fighting Blindness.
I'm Shanola Hampton. Every day, millions of people face hunger. Today, I will share with you some of their experiences. I'm stuck between paying for medications or paying for food. John from Maine. After paying my bills, I can buy groceries. It's sad to say, food comes last. Alice from Oregon. I thought pantries were for less fortunate people, but anybody could be less fortunate in a day or even a second. Claire from Virginia. The Feeding America Network of Food Banks helps provide over 6 billion meals to people in need each year. No one should have to worry where their next meal will come from. Together, we can end hunger. Learn more at feedingamerica.org.
You're listening to the new 101.7 The Truth, founded in partnership with Gruber Law Offices. One call, that's all. 101.7 FM, 1510 AM, WGKB Waukesha, and W269 DL Milwaukee, a locally owned Good Karma brand station.
This is The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 101.7thetruth.com.
Dreams of you, dreams of you are so fine, so fine. Since I woke up, so is my state of mind.
Ooh. Welcome to hour 3 of The Truth for Sure. When he was, I'm gonna read some text messages. Monique says, send her to Dr. Howard Fuller Collegiate Academy. There's a waiting list. Draco says, that goes back to administration wimpy policies. Draco also says middle school kids are ruthless. Dion wants to know if I got the picture he sent. Dion, no, I didn't, and I'm scared to open it because it's probably you wearing a wet T-shirt. Wait, here it is. What the hell is this? What is that? Board of Election Commissioners. Is this the picture you sent me of a voting machine? Hang on a second. What are we looking at here? Why you send me a picture of a voting machine, Dion? Did you steal that? Did you steal a voting machine? This is how all the ballots spelled wrong, get counted. Ray says, but my question is, why should a renter be responsible for a property owner's taxes? You can't be serious, Ray. You can't be serious. You know, when you rent, you're also responsible for the mortgage. When you rent, you're also financially, like, what do you think your rent is made up as? Made up of? It's the expenses of the landlord's expenses of owning the dwelling. The maintenance, the upkeep, cutting the grass, removing the snow, repairs, wear and tear on the building. As a renter, you are indirectly responsible for all that. So when you have a problem with something, you call the landlord comes and fixes it. But that's why you pay a security deposit. You are responsible for incidentals, including increases in property taxes. So, Ray, you don't actually think that if somebody is living in a property, let's say for 10 years, because some of y'all rent for your whole life, let's say 20 years, right? And in the span of 20 years, those property taxes go up 75%. You think the renter is not going to shoulder the burden of the increase in taxes that the landlord is facing? Of course. Pilar says, good morning. I'm currently reading this book, only 38 pages in, but NPS has always been a mess dating back to the 1900s. Ray says, I'm just thinking it should be illegal for a landlord to raise the tenant's rent because the landlord's property taxes has increased. That's all I'm saying. So the landlords were probably going to raise your rent anyway. Now they have an excuse to raise it more and to raise it more often. So I don't know if Wisconsin has, there's some states that have enacted, like, not moratoriums on increasing rent, but landlords can't increase the rent more than a certain amount per year or a certain percentage. I don't know if we have those limits here. Can I get a renter to call? I haven't rented in a very long time. And the last rent I paid, and I lived in River West on Humboldt, and I paid $605 a month for a one-bedroom, probably, it was a decent-sized apartment now, probably 600 square feet, and I paid $605 a month, but that included underground parking. It really wasn't that bad. But for those of you that rent, how has your rent gone up? Does it go up every year? Like, how does that work? Does it go up every 5 years? Do you have a nice landlord? Like, how does that work? I don't know how it works. Pilar says, flexible seating. My students are allowed to choose an alternative space to work after instructional time. Well, I guess that makes sense. Because having a kid just sit down, I had a hard time with that too. Because I was restless as a kid. Plus, I was real bored when I was in school. I come to find that out many years later. It was stupid. They weren't teaching Sherwin stuff. They should have been teaching me about public policy and campaign finance, and I learned about Mary Had a Little Lamb. It was stupid. I didn't learn enough stuff. I didn't really learn or appreciate learning until I got to college. What else we got here in these text messages? Let's see here. 833-212-1017. Gene says, Kingdom Prep Lutheran School, 414-727-9979. Kingdom Prep is an all-boys Christian school with a majority black student body and several black male teachers and administrators. Please look at the Brotherhood on their website. It's an amazing thing they're trying to do with these young men, teaching them in an environment of family. Okay, I never heard of that. She gave me the little website. Here's your Kingdom Prep Lutheran School. But that's a private school, Gene. I bet you probably have to apply for the Parental Choice Program and get a voucher to go there. DJ says MPS now allows paraprofessionals or teachers' assistants to test for jobs. They no longer need college credits. Dion said, as a lunch lady, they throw away so much food, it's a waste. What happens to those square pizzas? Y'all remember square pizzas? Everywhere we went to school. Alex, you went to school, in Illinois? Did you have square pizzas?
I think mine was a circle, but like small too.
Oh, you had circle pizza. Yeah. Oh, well, la-dee-da. What about you, Ricky? What kind of pizza you have in school? Square pizza?
It was square pizza.
All right, thank you. He's a normal person. Round. The only round pizza we had is when we had Mexican pizza. It was like an octagon. Like, I don't know, they had to differentiate. Like, you couldn't have square or rectangle Mexican pizza. It had to be octagon. It's almost like that pizza had an accent.
I remember it wasn't even pizza at one point. It was just bread. Like, it was basically cheese bread, and they would call it pizza.
No, that's what happens when you go to Illinois schools.
Yeah.
In Wisconsin, we at least got that pizza is, you know how much money I'd pay for some rectangle cafeteria pizza? I'd pay $8, $9 a slice. Let's see what else we got here. Dion says, it makes me sick to hear white folks act like we're a charity case. If they would have allowed us to advance, we would be ahead of them. That's exactly why they won't. We are a charity case. We sometimes like to play the victim. Everybody likes to play the victim because it gets you attention. Like, I was blamed yesterday. Oh, I love when this happens. Because I didn't explain the constitutional amendment referendums good enough. So it was my fault. Like, I'm assuming that you all are adults and you're all independent people and you take care of your responsibilities and you're high functioning adults. If I have to spoon feed you, and if the constant rote rehearsal of me talking about things so that we all can be on the same page, if that's not enough, not for most of you, it is enough. But for some of you, if that's not enough, then why don't we do this? If I got to spoon feed you information to make you understand it, give me your social security number so I can claim you as a dependent on my taxes. But Sherwin, you didn't explain it good enough. I needed to know better. That ain't my responsibility. I share the information. I do my best to break it down, demystify, and decipher the information. But if you don't get it, there's nothing I can do. I can't do anything. What is this one here? Millicent said we moved to Brown Deer in 1974. James says, OMG, a basketball hoop. They don't get it, Mr. Hughes. Pilar sent a photograph, which I am unable to see. I get nervous when y'all send me photographs because I never know what it's going to be. All right, we caught up on the text messages. No, we're not. D. Wood says, I feel the same way about January 6th. If majority of the people who showed up to the Capitol were black, they would still be picking up bodies. True. Millicent, just admit that you hate black people. It's fine if you do. A lot of people hate black people. Millicent, you hate blacks a lot. Who hurt you? Is that what you say to somebody? Who hurt you? What else we got here? Martin says, good morning, my brother. White folks come out of nowhere. If the referendum numbers increase, why city attorney numbers stayed the same? I guess they only voted yes. Really, they stole a quarter billion. I don't know if y'all saw the results of the city attorney election. And so there's a heat map that's available. I put it in the Hughes Views Facebook group if you want to go check it out. The voting, when you have a black candidate versus a white candidate in the city of Milwaukee, never fail. The voting patterns represent the racial segregation. White people that live West Side, Washington Heights, Washington Highlands, a few pockets of white folks on the far northwest side, and then all along what I call the eastern seaboard of Milwaukee, the east side over there, all vote for the white candidates. Now, Tierman Spencer did have some challenges. You know, I've known Tierman for a long time. He actually, believe it or not, was doing really, really good legal work on behalf of the city and the citizens of Milwaukee, but he didn't communicate it. So they would write a bad story about him in the Journal Sentinel, and then now he want to come on the radio and push back on the bad story instead of constantly communicating to the public the good work that he was doing while he was city attorney. And again, what I tried to tell him, I tried to tell him for years, like, dude, you're doing really good work. You got to share that information with the public. But sometimes people that get elected to public office are not good public officials because you have to disclose everything. You don't really get a personal life. Your professional life is public. You got to talk about everything that you're doing, all the accomplishments. You got to talk about what's coming up next. You got to talk about the wins. You got to talk about the losses. You have to be very transparent with the public. And a lot of times, if you're a lawyer, that's counter and contrary to how you operate, because lawyers keep a lot of information clandestine. They don't share it. They don't feel comfortable sharing it because it can oftentimes compromise their cases. That is why, as a lawyer that's also a public official, you have to almost like change your lawyer brain and have to be like, you have to overshare information to the public, because if the public knows that you're doing good work in your office, the amount of bad behavior we will excuse is incredible. We liked what Bill Clinton did. Now, we can have an argument about Bill Clinton all you want. We can argue and yell and scream about Bill Clinton, but Bill Clinton put black kids in school and college. Crime was going down. We were making money. We were making monumental strides during the Clinton administration. In fact, black people did so much better. Now, there was also a little crack going on, but let's talk about that later. We did so much better during the Clinton administration. We had the nerve and the audacity to call Bill Clinton our first black president. Bill Clinton was so good for us, or he made policies that made it easier for black folks to apply themselves and succeed in America. We didn't care about Monica Lewinsky at all.
Swallowed up. Have you ever been swallowed up?
Perfect. I didn't care. In fact, when Bill Clinton got caught, I was like 21. I was like, and? I was like, that's expected. He's the president. What's wrong with him? Thank you. Let's talk to Ashley. Hi, Ashley. How are you today?
Hi, I'm doing good. I just wanted to comment on you spoke about how you want the social security number of the people that want you to instruct them a little deeper on the politics.
Yes.
I do, and I understand your frustration fully, but I feel like that's going to be what gets us back at our greatest as a people, black people. The people that know better got to teach the other people to do better. It might be strenuous, it might be exhausting, but it's necessary. The ones that know better have to teach the other ones to do better. And I feel like we have to be a little bit more patient, just a tad bit. Think about all of the stuff that's been, not saying that it's an excuse that people aren't informed, but just look at history and look at what's all been put upon us. We know what's been going on. We know what people have to go through. Not saying that's an excuse to not be educated, but let's be realistic about it. It's a lot of stuff that people are balancing, and unfortunately, it caused education to take a back burner, especially politics. So I feel like the ones that know better, especially in the black community, we have a responsibility to do that extra teaching. It might be exhausting or strenuous at the moment, but we got to look at the bigger picture and how monumental it will be once we all do have an understanding. And we got to be a little patient because everybody is not on the same level. Even we talk about NPS all the time and how students are behind, and not even just NPS. This is a problem amongst the whole country in urban areas. But I feel like we just need to be a little more patient with ourselves and understand the trauma that we've been going through and understand why some people don't have that stuff that's like second nature or common sense to others. We should be a little more empathetic, I guess I'm trying to say.
And I'm glad you, and I agree with you, Ashley, and I'm glad you said we, because I cannot do it alone. It requires exactly. folks like yourself, exactly. because here's the thing, right? There's some people, no matter how I break something down politically, they're never going to understand it. And like, how much do I need to hold up the class to like spoon feed somebody who's never, ever, ever going to understand? And then when they get it wrong, they're going to just blame me. So this is not a remedial radio show. There are remedial radio shows. And I appreciate people that listen. I love people that listen very much. But sometimes like what I say and how I say it is not going to be understood by people. And I can't just harp on it. I got to move to the other thing. Even though I got 3 hours a day,
that's
a lot
true.
Of days, 3 hours ain't enough. So I can't just make sure that the most like remedial of the people get it. Otherwise, we're not going to move forward at all. But that's where you come in handy, Ashley, because you get to talk to the people
very
and pull
true.
Them aside.
Exactly. I feel like what you made a very good comment. It shouldn't just be based on like these. We shouldn't leave it up to a few people. This is all of us. This one person can't be left to do that, because then they will come off as, when they do get exhausted, they'll come off as mean or run people away. You can get a little sarcastic with your education. I can't help it, Ashley.
I'm trying.
I see. You have me cracking up laughing, but I totally understand what you say. And if we all would come together, it wouldn't be as big of a burden on some people if we were all going together and do this. And I guess I am one of the people that have more patience because I've worked with like people, children with special education needs. There's people out here that has that knack for and that extra patience. I just feel like we all have to do it together. But I understand where you're coming from as well.
Thank you, Ashley. Appreciate your call. And
you're welcome.
Go put in some work teaching people how to understand stuff. What is this one here? Cedric said, unrelated to anything we've been discussing today. Cedric said, I was treated terribly a couple days ago by Frontier Airlines. I need some help on how to go after them. Well, first of all, you flew Frontier. All right, Cedric, are you able to call me? I want to hear your story. Cedric was treated poorly by Frontier Airlines. They didn't make you ride in the baggage claim, did they? What happened? Because I've never flown Frontier. I don't even like flying Southwest, but they take me direct to Florida without having any layovers. So if you're able to call us, Cedric, give us a call. Let us know what happened to you on Frontier Airlines. Did they take you to the wrong destination? What did they do? Did they not give you a drink service? We'll hopefully hear from him and see what happened on Frontier Airlines. Sometimes if an airplane ticket is really, really cheap, it's for a reason. So I want to bring back Midwest Express. That was the best care in the air. You are listening to the best care on the air, The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 FM. Don't go anywhere. I'll be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
The baseball season is finally here, and we want to celebrate the Milwaukee Brewers with you, Truth Nation. We are excited to announce our Take Me Out to the Ball Game giveaway. From now through the end of April, we will be giving away tickets to cheer on the Brewers live from American Family Field. For your chance to win a pair of tickets to a game, you must download the 1017 The Truth app and be on the lookout for our weekly Brewers Push notification. Play ball with The Truth and go watch The Brew Crew by downloading the 1017 The Truth app today. For contest rules, visit 1017thetruth.com.
The Empowerment Small Business Loan Program, we're talking about up to $5 million, which for small business owners, we need that. That's like payroll, that's resources. So can you just let us know, what is the program and why is this lending program so important to Old National Bank?
Years ago, our CEO, Jim Ryan, this program is his brainchild. He was working with Roland Shelton, who you know, Denise, out of Evansville. And they identified that African-American business owners, Hispanic business owners, Native American business owners, as well as women business owners, had a difficult time in obtaining financing from the traditional credit partners. And so we went out, created a program, launched it last year in 2023. And so far last year, we have helped over 100 successful minority and women-owned businesses with about $25 million in loans. We've already started this year with almost $8 million in approvals, again, geared toward minority business owners and women business owners that normally had difficulties in obtaining traditional credit finance.
Your drink, sir?
This virtual vacation is brought to you by Milwaukee Mitchell International Airport. For the full experience, visit flymke.com to explore our many nonstop destinations. With super convenient parking and low fares, flying from Milwaukee makes traveling so easy, it's like starting your vacation early. Fly easy, fly MKE.
Bucks Partial Plans are now available for the 2024-25 season. These ticket plans are designed to put the power in your hands. So map out your ultimate game day experiences by selecting the opponents and seat locations that work best for your budget. Immerse yourself in the excitement of hand-picking your Bucks games. Enjoy your choice of thrilling rivalries, cross-conference picks, and matchups between the NBA's greatest. Visit bucks.com/partial to map out your partial plan. That's bucks.com/partial.
It's early in the year and we're trying to hit these fitness goals. 0 to 100 Fitness is dedicated to the Milwaukee community, offering affordable and quality fitness and mixed martial arts programs for the last 10 years. They have competitive and novice classes in MMA, kickboxing, and grappling for all skill levels and ages. From youth, community outreach, women's self-defense, and personal safety programs, 0 to 100 Fitness will help you on your journey to greatness. So get up off the couch and into the best shape of your life. Call 414-522-1275 today.
It's The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 1017 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Truth Nation, it's a big week for First Stage. A classic book series is coming to a live stage near you. Diary of a Wimpy Kid musical is coming to life at the First Stage Children's Theater in downtown Milwaukee. Bring the whole family to see this classic book turned into a musical by visiting firststage.com. The show runs at the Marcus Performing Arts Center from April 6th to May 5th. Get your tickets today to see Diary of a Wimpy Kid musical by visiting firststage.com for tickets. All right, go see the Wimpy Kid Diary musical. Let's talk to... Hello, Cedric. How are you?
Oh, pretty good. How you doing?
I'm doing good. So what happened on Frontier Airlines?
I'll try to make it as brief as it can, man, but it was terrible. So flying with my family, about 12 of us, we were just about ready to pull off, and police come on the plane and pull me off the plane.
Uh-oh.
So I go out. I'm like, hey, you know, what's going on? He's like, hey, you got a gun in your luggage, and you didn't declare it. And I was like, no, I always travel with it, and I'm sure I declared it. So we had to go downstairs, talk to the agent. The agent, until I got there, she was saying, oh, no, he didn't claim it, blah, blah, blah. So when I got down there, she remembered.
So what is the process? Hold on a second. I got to make sure I get all the information here, Cedric. So how do you, when you buy your ticket, like, where do you claim or give notice you have a firearm, which is a risky proposition anyway, but where do you let them know that you have a gun? And do you have any, like, a receipt or confirmation that, yes, I let them know that I got a firearm and then somebody responded to you? Like, how does that work?
So what happens is when you get to the counter, you have to declare it. Say, hey, I'm traveling with a firearm. They fill out a form. They give you the form. They make you open your luggage. You put the form inside of the luggage, just letting them know that, yeah, I did mention I have a firearm.
And you did all that. So the form was in your luggage.
I did all. Well, she fills the form out and puts it in there.
Oh.
So somehow with all the confusion, we were traveling like 12 of us. So somehow with all the confusion, she didn't do it. So when I got back down there, she said, oh, I remember. He did declare it. She said it was my fault. I forgot to do what I was supposed to do. It was completely my fault.
Okay.
So I said, okay, no problem. In the meantime, my flight left. My family's on the flight. They have no idea where I'm at, what happened to me. The flight took off. I said, listen, you guys need to get me to Midway somehow to meet up with my family. So after looking on the computer, she comes back and says, we can get you to Milwaukee, but you can't get home until tomorrow night. And I'm like, no, that's not an option. You know, you can't just pull me off the flight. This is your mistake. We sat there going back and forth with managers. In the meantime, I'm asking for information. What's your name? They all turned their IDs around, so I couldn't get the information.
Uh-oh.
This time, you got 5-6 police officers surrounded. They're listening to the story because here it is. I don't want this guy to get angry. He's got a gun in his back. But I told them, no, I'm not, you know, I'm not on none of that.
No, where was your luggage? Was your luggage on the flight with your family, or was it with you?
Oh, it was sitting right in front of me.
Oh, so you had the heat in the bag right in front of you. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So they, even the police were agreeing. It's like, man, you guys aren't willing to accommodate this guy, no how, no way. So all said and done, I had to buy another flight from United to get home. I called management when I get home late that night. And they offered me a $100 voucher for next time I fly. And I've been in touch with every single person. Now, you can't talk to anybody at Frontier. This is just through email and text and no way to talk to anybody. And I just feel like, man, I just feel like I was just treated like a piece of crap. And it's crazy.
So well, started like a misunderstanding, but at least Frontier gave you the $100 voucher. I mean, you probably could file a complaint with the FAA. That's the federal agency that regulates the airlines, but I mean, that might be worth it, but like, what are you expecting? You want a free flight on Frontier again? If I were you, I'd just stay away from Frontier. Flying. Okay.
I'm never flying Frontier, but it cost me $600 to get home to United.
Ooh-wee.
Yeah, I had to get home. Yeah, my family's separated. My mother can't hardly walk, so she depends on me. So all of this because of you guys' mistake, and all you're willing to offer me is a voucher.
Yeah.
That doesn't even cover the cost of the original flight.
Right.
And I didn't fly.
So you didn't go at all?
I didn't go at all. Never got on the flight.
No. Where were y'all going?
No, my family, we were coming back to Milwaukee from Phoenix.
Oh, okay.
Yep. And yeah, I'm getting nowhere.
Have you heard back from anybody? Because Frontier, I'm sure they've got customer service lines and email addresses. Have you heard back from anyone at Frontier other than getting your $100 voucher?
No, nobody.
Okay.
That's all. Everyone keeps saying, well, we offered you a $100 voucher. And like, do you guys really think that's appropriate?
Have you submitted to them how much it costs you to the $600 it costs you for a returning flight? They should at least reimburse you for that.
They don't care. They said no. They're not reimbursing that. They're only giving me the $100 voucher to fly on it with them again. That's it.
This might be over my head. I don't know what to do. Maybe here. Let me see. Give me a minute, Cedric. Let me figure something out.
Okay.
Okay.
All
right.
Thanks.
Thank you for calling the consumer complaint line here at 101.7 The Truth. That's not fair. Shouldn't they reimburse them for the $600? See what it's like being black? Being black in America. For white people, it always want to know what it's like being black. Being black in America is like having a gun in your luggage. Not being able to fly. Being surrounded by police and then being out $600. Yeah, I don't know what you would do in that situation other than not fly Frontier, I guess. Donna Owen says, the best pizza. I agree. Square cafeteria pizza from a school. James said, sure, when people can't be serious, you kept telling them that rents will increase if it passes. They are expecting the homeowners to pay the bill. Shaking my head. Definitely a lot of misinformed people out there. We are in a world of trouble. Rodney says, no social security numbers. Tell them to send money in Bitcoin. What? No social security numbers. Tell them to send money to purchase Bitcoin at the gas station for them. They'll do that. I don't know what that means. And Linda just sent us a picture. Linda, for some reason, when you send pictures to our text line, I can't open them. So I don't know what it is. Knowing you, Linda, it might be something very inappropriate. So call us if you can, but right now I got to take a break. We got to get back to talking about education stuff because that's what we're talking about today. And Frontier Airlines, apparently. My advice, don't fly Frontier. You're welcome. The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 FM. We'll be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
Associated Bank knows your small business isn't just a venture. It's your dream and a vital part of the community. And we're not just a bank. We're your neighbors. We're looking out for you. That's why Associated Bank offers quick online applications and approvals with funding in as fast as one business day, checking with no minimum balances or maintenance fees, and prompt customer service. Explore our products at associatedbank.com/business or visit a branch for more details. Subject to credit approval. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Looking for natural solutions to ease your mind and body? Find your calm and get cozy at Torch CBD with their hemp-infused teas, or boost your health with broad-spectrum CBD products. From CBD-infused cooking oil, honey and coffee, to body creams, edibles, and smokable flower. Torch CBD, located at 3419 West State Street in Milwaukee, is ready to help with all your trauma, anxiety, and sleep issues. Stop by Torch CBD today and relax your mind.
It's time for Truth Takes, a thought-provoking commentary on the new 101.7 The Truth. Here is Melanie Ricks with her truth.
What's up, everybody? It's Melanie Ricks from Nothing But The Truth with Melanie Ricks. A thought that I have on my mind today, you have to put out the energy that you want to receive in return. I've noticed recently that I tend to have expectations for others that I don't also have for myself. For example, if I text my friend, I expect them to respond instantly. But if somebody texts me, oh, I'll take my time and respond whenever I'm good and ready to. So why is it that I feel as if others have to get back to me right away if I'm not willing to get back to them? That's just one minor example. But when it comes to work, let's say you're feeling dissatisfied with your job performance or maybe with the atmosphere, what's going on with work, perhaps that you're hoping for a promotion of some sort and things just aren't going the way that you want. Okay, so what are you doing to fix that? What are you doing to work your way towards a better work situation? What is the energy that you are putting toward your job, toward your coworkers, even when it comes to family dynamics and other relationships, or perhaps encounters with strangers? What is the energy that you are giving to the people around you? And what is the energy that you expect in return? I sincerely believe in the law of attraction, and I very much do feel that what you put out is what you will receive. So if you are someone who feels as if you are not getting the best out of things in life, perhaps it's because you are not putting your best foot forward and you are not putting the best energy that you can toward those things. The law of attraction is real, y'all. I'm telling you.
Listen to Nothing But The Truth with Melanie Ricks, weekdays from noon to 1 p.m. This is The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 1017thetruth.com.
April is Financial Literacy Month, and The Truth has you covered on learning about how you can best manage your finances. All April, we will speak with representatives from Educators Credit Union to discuss financial strategies and tools they offer to their members to help enhance your financial management skills. Financial Literacy Month on the award-winning 101.7 The Truth is sponsored by Educators Credit Union, Achieving More Together. And baseball season is finally here, and we want to celebrate the Milwaukee Brewers with you, Truth Nation. From now through the end of the month, we will be giving away tickets to cheer on the Brewers live from American Family Field. For your chance to win a pair of tickets to a game, you have to download the 101.7 The Truth app and be on the lookout for a notification that'll come through that app. Play ball with Truth, The Truth, and go watch the Brew Crew by downloading the 101.7 The Truth app today. So we'll give you a notification and be like, hey, be caller number something, and you'll get some tickets to go see the Brewers. Let's talk to Gregory. You're on 101.7 The Truth. How are you?
I'm fine. Thanks for calling me by my full name.
Well, that's what it said here on the thing. On my screen, it said Gregory.
Hey, listen, Sherwin, you know what? But someone said you didn't understand, I think, the last text that mentioned something about money for bitcoins.
Yeah, was that you that said that?
No, sir. But what I wanted to say, that's kind of when you talk about kind of being a consumer protection program, that's kind of like the number one scam in Wisconsin right now going on where people, the news last night was warning everyone to be careful about submitting money to these machines, these Bitcoin machines, and then calling these people and they're saying, take the money to the big. It's a real interesting story that I think Wisconsin is being scammed more than any other state in America.
A Bitcoin machine? So wait, help me understand this, Gregory.
I vaguely watched the program, but I saw it and I caught it, and I just saw one lady's out of 17 grand, another guy's out of 24 grand, another, and so they're saying, hey, beware. There's these machines that are supposedly distribution sites for bitcoins, and they say right on there, be careful. They're warning signs. They're like ATM machines, so they're like warning signs, right, warning labels in bold print right on there that says, be careful. You can be scammed using this machine trying to purchase Bitcoin.
So wait, there's actual like Bitcoin machines stationed around the city of Milwaukee?
Yes, around the state. Yeah, I think it was Manitowoc, so not far from Milwaukee.
Well, they probably deserve it up there in Manitowoc. We know better than Milwaukee. I don't mess with no cryptocurrency. Somebody just asked me today if I own cryptocurrencies and Bitcoin. I don't mess with no coin I can't put in my pocket and hear jingle. I don't mess with no fake coin. It ain't even a real coin. It's just like an internet thing. But all right, Gregory, I appreciate the call, and we'll stay vigilant.
Okay, my buddy.
All right. Thank you for the call. Bitcoin, I wish I would. I tried my little hand at Bitcoin years and years ago. I thought it was stupid, and I sold my Bitcoin. It's stupid. Yeah, it's going up in value, but it'll go down in value, too. It's not even real. I prefer stocks. Stocks, mutual funds, and trading call and put options. Let's talk to Linda, I hope you didn't buy that Jeep. Go ahead, do your intro. Get it over with.
Good morning, Sherwin, Professor Sherwin. Good morning, good comment, Brandon. Good morning. All the good black and white people love Milwaukee. I love you guys. Hey, Sherwin.
What?
That you were so funny last Friday. You was like, and it's ugly. It is ugly, but
it's a weird color of green, Linda, and you wouldn't look good driving in that.
The contrast, though, I thought the ugly, rough, rugged masculine with the soft, feminine, you know, in driving. I thought it was a nice contrast, but yeah, I just needed someone to just point that out.
Have you test driven it? Did you drive it? Jeeps ride terrible. They're very uncomfortable.
I changed my mind altogether because they kept, you know, forcing me and telling me that I can't leave, and I had to make up my mind. I was like, no. One thing I'm not is a fool. So at the end of the day, I was like, she's intimidating. Well, I'm going to have to sell it if, you know, you have to leave, da, da, da. I told her, you sell it.
Did you get your money back? But didn't you give him $2,500?
Yeah, I told him I'm not going to be rushed to do anything. So, because I had even changed to look at a Honda, same 41,000 miles on it, same price, $31,900.
What kind of Honda, Linda? Like, you just don't know anything about cars, do you?
No, because I'm not a materialist person like that. You guys,
Linda,
you know,
needing a vehicle for transportation has nothing to do with being materialistic. That's like going to the grocery store trying to shop and don't know nothing about food. What kind of Honda is it, Linda?
I don't know.
You don't even know what kind of. Good God. You need a man.
Sherwin.
And we try to hook you up with a man. And you say, I don't need no man. Yes, you do. You need several men.
I didn't never say, I'm never one that says, I don't need a man. I'm not that kind of woman. I understand the relationship that is needed as far as a man and a woman. But I am very selective, Sherwin. But listen, no, I just decided not to deal with them altogether. That's why I didn't go into it. You know, so I want to look into other, I think you had mentioned two other places, so I was going to go there. And
Linda,
and
you need to start by knowing what kind of car you want, not what dealership you're going to pick.
Yes, that's
what
true.
Kind of vehicle that's do you
true.
Want?
That's true.
Do you want an SUV? That's do you want
true.
Something that's
true.
Economical? What do you want?
No, I want something for a single lady who is classy and smart and, you know, sophisticated.
Linda, those are ridiculous reasons. Your transportation first needs to be practical. It needs to get you where you need to go reliably. And why would you, if you need all those things, why in the hell would you pick a two-door Jeep Wrangler with a soft top? You look ridiculous in that.
I told you.
Your wig would fly off if you put the top down. Your wig would be on the highway. Your wig would look like a kite in the air. And people think it's a UFO, but it's Linda's wig.
You need to stop it. But, Sherwin, the reason why I called, though, I don't want to put that back because I know I got little time left. I used to teach the wimpy kid. That was the best. Those stories are the best. The wimpy kid and all of them, they were just the best. I would have my students act out each character that they would, you know, take on the character's portion of the story. It was wonderful, very wonderful. That just took me back. But I also wanted to comment about the caller who said that, you know, we need to reach back and help our others. And that's true. That is so very true. It's actually embedded in biblical scriptures. However, I want to say that in Milwaukee in particular, that I'm sorry to say, Black people don't think that way. We want to hold, you know, information that would help another excel because we don't want another to excel over us or know more than us because we, you know, we acting like crabs in a barrel in Milwaukee as far as the Black, you know, community. And I think that that's appalling. It's disrespectful and it's self-destructive, ultimately. And then I wanted to comment about the percentage of people who are non-Black, childless that's in there that voted yes for the referendum. You know, again, yes, you can see the bias in it, the political agenda, which ultimately, again, it's selling the intellectual potential of our children out the window. And this is the things that the politics have, you know, shaded over as far as Mandela, as far as Posley, you know, and the governor and the mayor who support them. We're not going into the classrooms to see the actual culture and the reality of what's going on and how those fundings is not going into the classroom to resolve these issues. Yes, I was threatened at Obama School and the principal I was in the doctor's school with. I told her, no, I'm leaving. They stole my phone.
They stole your phone.
Intimidating. Yeah, stole my cell phone out the drawer. And when I inquired to them about it, this is tall teenagers now, tall as I am. And see, I got a temper. I got a temper too. So when they were intimidating me, I knew I had to go to the principal, meet with her, let her know I feel threatened. There's no one, to secure my safety immediately. So I want to leave. And that was it. And she was upset. But, yeah, I had to leave because I knew if I go back in that classroom, it was going to be a problem. I'm going to defend myself. And then you have the lower, you know, grades. Yes, those children, now their mentality is, oh, we're going to take them over because we know the law. We know they can't do this and that, so we're going to challenge them. See, all of this needs to be readdressed and you know, resolved.
How?
Because I think that MPS should have a class action lawsuit, and I think it's probably mounting to that.
Who's going to sue the school? We can't sue. Why we already sued the school district. They already aren't complying. You can't sue your way out of the situation we're in. What happens is MPS eventually, after this referendum, I think the taxpayer scrutiny is going to go up finally, and they're going to get broken up into smaller districts. They're going to have smaller clusters of schools where there can be more watchful eyes over what's happening in these five schools, and we'll put individual people over the responsibility of looking at how these five schools perform, how these 10 schools perform. I think that is our best course of action, because right now it is too big, there's too much bureaucracy, there's way too much politics, and they have gotten away from focusing on the child's achievement. Yeah. Yes, they want smaller class sizes. We need a smaller district.
And that's what was always the objective, even when I started. And that was, you know, now 30 years ago. So, 40 years ago. So that's always been the ultimate objective, was to break them down. But I thought that the union didn't support that, you know. So.
Thanks, Linda. And good luck trying to find a car, because you're going to need
it. I will let you know.
All right. Better luck finding a man in a car, because it's going to be tough for Linda. Linda don't even know what kind of Honda she was looking at. Okay. I have to take a commercial break now. We're listening to The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on the 101.7, the award-winning New Truth at the American Family Insurance Studio. I never say it. The American Family Insurance Studio in the 3rd Street Market Hall in the middle of downtown in the Grand Avenue Mall, where it's a food court. I'll be right back.
More of The Truth with Sherwin Hughes is next on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 101.7thetruth.com.
Truth Nation, join the Truth team on Saturday, April 13th for our third annual Tory Lowe Community Cleanup. We want you to go to truthcommunitycleanup.com to sign up and be a volunteer to help keep Milwaukee clean. Everyone who joins will get a free lunch provided by Cousin Subs. Register today at truthcommunitycleanup.com. That is truthcommunitycleanup.com to clean and beautify our city together. The Truth Community Cleanup is sponsored by Cousin Subs and Safe and Sound.
The Empowerment Small Business Loan Program, we're talking about up to $5 million, which for small business owners, we need that. That's like payroll, that's resources. So can you just let us know, what is the program and why is this lending program so important to Old National Bank?
Years ago, our CEO, Jim Ryan, this program is his brainchild. He was working with Roland Shelton, who you know, Denise, out of Evansville. And they identified that African-American business owners, Hispanic business owners, Native American business owners, as well as women business owners, had a difficult time in obtaining financing from the traditional credit partners. And so we went out, created a program, launched it last year, 2023. And so far last year, we have helped over 100 successful minority and women-owned businesses with about $25 million in loans. We have already started this year with almost $8 million in approvals, again, geared toward minority business owners and women business owners that normally had difficulties in obtaining traditional credit finance.
Protect your dream home with American Family Insurance. And you can weather any storm. You'll also save up to 25% by bundling home, auto, and life. American Family Insurance. Get a quote. Find an agent at amfam.com.
Products not available in every state. Discounts may not apply to all coverages on an auto or home policy. Discounts do not apply to life insurance policies. Visit amfam.com to learn how discounts may apply to you. American Family Mutual Insurance Company, S.I. and its operating companies, American Family Life Insurance Company, 6000 American Parkway, Madison, Wisconsin.
We Energies want you to keep this important safety message in mind. Before you start digging, planting, or landscaping on your property, call 811 to have underground utilities marked. Calling 811 at least 3 business days before you plan to dig will help you know what's below and can prevent a hazardous situation. Our representatives will mark the underground utilities on your property for free. So remember, stay safe and call before you dig.
We Energies, people you can trust, energy you can depend on.
Ever feel stuck in a mental maze, endlessly spiraling? Sometimes an encouraging reminder helps. Be Sad, Keep Going is a mental health and wellness brand by Marina Miranda Creative. It reminds you it's okay to feel sad as long as you keep moving forward. By embracing your emotions, you're not just improving your health, but rewriting the narrative for generations to come. Join the movement today and claim 10% off their range of apparel using code KEEPGOING10. That's KEEPGOING10 when you visit MarinaMirandaCreative.com. Be Sad, Keep Going is dedicated to improving mental health by reminding you of your resilience.
It's The Truth with Sherwin Hughes on 101.7 The Truth, The Truth app, and 101.7thetruth.com.
Gerardo says, Sherwin, if Tara's considering United Community Center on the south side for her little person, I can get her connected. Miss Nikki says, hello, Sherwin. It's surprising that some people believe that their rent only covers the renter's living space. No, the rent covers mortgage insurance, property taxes, maintenance, and upkeep. If renters understood that they were paying for all of those costs associated with the property that they are renting, they would just purchase a home of their own. Unfortunately, I have no choice but to raise the rents on my property to cover the increased property taxes. Eddie just sent me a link. What is that link, Eddie? I don't like clicking links because if it's a messed up link and I screw up these studio computers, Tori Lowe will be mad at me. Yeah, I'm going to take a chance on you, Eddie. Let me see what this link is. What is this? A Bitcoin. Oh, here's about the Bitcoin scam. These are two really, really old white people sitting in an empty, like, hall with an American flag on the wall. Good luck, whites. Black folks ain't falling for no Bitcoin scam. Not us. CeCe says, just an FYI on the rental increase policy for the state of Wisconsin from steadily.com. Wisconsin has no legislation capping rent increases. Landlords can set new rents. They often consider market rates to remain competitive. Any disputes over what constitutes an excessive rent increase can be brought before a court where tenants may seek legal advice. Can one of y'all look this up? If you find it, put it on my Facebook page. It gives like a percentage of the amount of available renters units by city. It's a percentage, right? So like Chicago would be like, you know, 72% of the units are full. Detroit would be like 81%. I remember coming across this story some time ago, but I didn't send it to myself and didn't have it for conversation on air. But Milwaukee's rental units are pretty much full. We're like better than 90 or 95% of all the apartments and townhouses and duplexes that are available for rent are full, which means if there's a high demand for rental units and there's none available, that is going to cause the price of rent to go up. Plus the property tax increase. Now, so I've been told. The property taxes are not going to increase for calendar year 2024 because we still have either budgeted money or COVID money or some other money the MPS is going to use this first year of 2024. But in 2025, it's going to hit you. In 2026, it's going to get you. In 2027, you're going to have a fit. Just so you know. Al says, Sherwin about Frontier Airlines, $100 is the starting offer from customer service. They start out low to see what you will accept in case you decide to go up the corporate chain or to the media. Al from Sherman Park, former FunJet Vacations and Midwest Express employee. So, Cedric, I hope you just didn't. Well, he said he didn't. Well, maybe he did accept $100, but he was just mad that they offered him $100. I didn't know that. That's actually good information. Chauncey says you can't trust those bootleg-ass Bitcoin machines. I didn't know that Bitcoin machines even existed. Do I need to look this up? Because I don't even know how that would work. So if I have cash or a credit card, so I go to a machine and want to turn my currency, debit card, credit card, or cash into Bitcoin. But for what, though? Because you can do a Bitcoin exchange online. I don't know. I don't even know why I'm troubling myself with this. Millicent says, just a question. Why do people fly with a gun? So you can go shooting when you get to your destination or go hunting? People fly with guns all the time. But a man that was flying with 11 of his other family members going to Arizona. I don't know. I don't question why people do stuff. I stop questioning why y'all do the things you do a long time ago, because most of what y'all do makes no sense to Sherwin. All right. I think we're good here on text messages. All right. What's going on YouTube? Eileen says, I spoke with a friend in the assessor's office last night. Property assessments are increasing this year. They held steady last year, and as a result, MPS will get even more revenue. Live You says to Eileen, they should have same quality. I don't consider them that a main reason for the lack of black teachers or lack of MPS students to teachers, if she said the difference is technology software. Back to my original story. For instance, in 1953, 1 year before the Supreme Court decision of Brown versus the Board of Education of Topeka, Kansas, teacher Darla Buchanan received a letter from Topeka, Kansas Superintendent Wendell Godwin. Quote, the majority of people in Topeka will not want to employ Negro teachers next year for white children. It is necessary for me to notify you now that your services will not be needed next year. Shortly after the Brown decision, the Moberly, Missouri School District closed a segregated black school, which led to the dismissal of 11 certified black teachers, including at least one who had a Ph.D. Some of the white teachers in the district who kept their jobs had fewer classroom experience or college credits than the black teachers who were dismissed, according to court documents. Seven of the dismissed black teachers sued the school district, claiming they lost their jobs because of their race. The court sided with the district, and the Supreme Court declined to hear the case. In the book, The Lost Education of Horace Tate, author Vanessa Siddle Walker tells the story of a black man in northern Georgia who had been a principal for 14 years. Once the school district began to integrate, administrators transferred half of the principal's students and half of the principal's students and half of his teachers and docked $3,000 from his salary. Eventually, the principal lost all of his students and was transferred to the superintendent's building. He was given a windowless room in an attic as an office, where he turned in his resignation and was humiliated. These types of stories were common pertaining black teachers. Today, many scholars say the persistent lack of black teachers in the profession can be traced to the aftermath and the resistance to Brown versus the Board of Education. All right, guys. Tomorrow, you may have to remind me. I want to talk about dating apps. And some of you have found love and companionship and relationships on dating apps. But did you know the actual intent of dating apps is to keep you single and to keep you using the app? We'll talk about that tomorrow. Until then, have a great day. I'll see you later.
1017 The Truth and Associated Bank have teamed up for our Black-owned business give back. Each quarter, we'll be giving away $6,000 worth of free commercial advertising for 3 months to five Black businesses. To sign up for your business's chance to win $6,000 of commercial campaign marketing on the award-winning 1017 The Truth,